Welcome back, everybody, from the lunch. We are now in the very capable hands of Ambassador Darlington Wafi.
Colleagues, welcome, and I trust that you had a good lunch. Yesterday I was listening to Kofi Annan, and he characterized Africa as being a rich continent with a lot of poor people. And that is because, you know, the resource is rich, but it's not translated into poverty reduction. And, you know, we've been discussing in the morning intra-African trade, also discussing regional integration at the SAIIA level. But we cannot do without external markets. We have to have our trading structured in such a way that our markets are diversified, because by nature, African countries are very susceptible to external shocks, so we need to have diversified market base. And in this regard, we will be looking in this session at the opportunities that we have in external markets, and these are in the European market through the economic partnership agreements, to the US through the AGOA, the African Growth Opportunity Act, and also we'll look at how, you know, in regard to the EPA, how the SADC EPA is interacting with the larger SADC region. You will recall that the SADC as a region was fragmented in terms of negotiations of the EPA. There was the SADC group, and then there was the ESA group, which took out a few of the SADC countries. So I will, at this stage, invite Ruma Narayanan from Mauritius. You know, it's good to hear from the private sector. She's from the Chamber of Commerce. She'll give the perspective of the ESA EPA negotiation from the private sector perspective. And then I'll invite Bonisiwe Ntando from Swaziland to also speak to the EPA SADC group negotiation from the private sector perspective as well. So, Ruma, you have 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Darlington. We have more than 5 minutes. It's okay. Well, initially I was invited to be a discussant, but finally I also had a few slides which I updated yesterday, so if it's okay, I'll present it to you. It's just to share with you the private perspectives of private sector perspectives rather of the EP, and also how we can link it to the region. It will be just in three phases, in three parts, from low mid to interim, an overview of our exports and EP in the region. Unfortunately, it looks a bit slow, a bit far and small. Just to tell you that the whole development of the agro-industry, your sector, and textile industry is fully something that came because of preferences that we had with EU, with Europe. In the 1970s, we started exporting sugar, developing the sugar industry and exporting sugar to Egypt under the sugar protocol. In the 1980s, we saw the development of the textile industry, again Euro-centered, towards exporting towards EU. 80s, 90s, started off some new sectors like jewelry and watch dials. And then in the year 2000, a new sector that came in was fish and fish products, again geared towards all exports towards EU. So if any of this more, I'm trying to get it afterwards, but what I've been saying is that for the last 40 to 50 years, we have been using Europe as our main export market, and Lomé up to now, Cotonou, and IEPA has helped us a lot in developing the industrial base for Mauritius. Looking at the total exports for 2013, that were the latest figures that I had, so Europe accounts at this stage for about 56% of our total exports. It used to be a bit more, a bit around 60 to 70%, maybe 10 years back. But since then, we have had new agreements with benefiting from AGOA and also the region, that and the share of exports to the EU, as the share of total exports has increased, but it still remains our main market, representing, as you see, about 56%. Strangely, we export mainly to four or five main markets in the EU, UK, France, Italy, and Spain, and not the rest of Europe. So our exports are geared towards these four or five main markets. So this is something that maybe we'll discuss later. In terms of product categories, you would see that the share of exports, in general, textile and clothing is big, fish and dish products, sugar, and jewelry, like I said, a lot of concentration in terms of products and in terms of markets, also four main markets that we export to the EU. We have seen over the past years some new products emerging, but the quantities are still small, and we hope that in the longer term, maybe can work out better for these industries. Exports to the region, I mean, I just had it there, but if it just give you a small breakdown of the type of exports that goes to the region as compared to what goes to the EU. We have a wider range of products, but in smaller quantities. Since 2009, so Mauritius has signed the interim EPA with the EU. As you're aware, when the discussions came up at the level of the ACP and EU, the ACP was broken down into six regions. Mauritius had the choice to choose to discuss with the SADC countries or the COMESA countries, and government decided it was best interest to go with COMESA member states. So that decision was taken in 2002, I think 2003. And since then, unfortunately, the ESA group has a bit disbanded or collapsed. I don't know how we can say that. The EAC countries, being a customs union, went on their own, and we're remaining with the rest, 12 to 13 countries. And also, when it came to time to sign the EPA, only four countries went to the desk and signed the EPA. Maurice, Madagascar, Seychelles, and Zimbabwe, the rest, as you see downstairs, were not ready to sign the EPA and didn't sign. So when we ended up signing, there were only four countries that were committed to sign. We didn't have much choice because we had to trade with the EU. It was our main trading partner, and we needed the preferences to continue. So we didn't have any choice. So we had to sign, and maybe we signed early and we didn't get the best deal because we see other EPAs have maybe better deals than us, but it is something we hope to rectify in the future. Officially, the discussions for a full EPA are still ongoing, but there are discussions with the EU, and Charlie knows about it, so we don't know what will happen to the full EPA. But technically, the discussions are supposed to continue for a full EPA that will cover services as well. We're supposed to liberalize tariff for Mauritius at least for over a 10-year period up to 2022. What have been the main changes in the interim EPAs compared to Cotonou? For us, big advantages. There are more flexible rules of origins for two of the main products that we export, which is garments and fish. For garments, it's now single transformation, and for selected products from the agro-industry, we have more flexible rules. And this is particularly interesting for us for a market which is nearby to us, which is La Réunion, which is a part of the French territory where we do export a lot of products from the agro-industry. And for fish, we have an increased derogation, which allows us to use fish caught by ships from different flags than EU or ESA to export eventually canned fish or preserved fish to EU, I'm sure, so I can expand a bit more on this. So these are two of the main wins that we had out of the EPA. New areas of cooperation are in the EPA, economic development, industrial cooperation, industrial development, milk, the fisheries and aquaculture industry, private sector development, natural resources and environment, I mean quite a whole lot of chapters. But our assessment is that the EPA has been signed since 2009. The implementation committee that meets once a year to view the implementation of the EPA is only working in the market access issue. So the other chapters of the EPA, we're not sure how this will be implemented and how this will be addressed to make sure that the capacity issues, the cooperation issues highlighted in the different chapters of the EPA, which is a big document, are implemented. This is something I think we have to address, and which for us as private sector is very crucial, because it looks at how to increase the productive capacity of industries, how to assess, how to ensure sustainable development, energy, and a lot of other issues. So it's something that for us will be crucial as well. So the benefits from the EPA are direct. It's secured market access for our exports to EU. I think I've shown that EU is up to now and will, I think, will remain for a long time our main market. It will allow us to consolidate our existing exports and also look at the other EU markets. There are 28 EU countries, we're exporting to about 5. So there's a lot of other countries to look at which we haven't looked at and which I think is a big potential that we probably are not focusing enough. With the different rules of origin, we hope we can diversify the range of products that we export. For example, for textile and garments, with the use of single transformation, some other products like swimwear, which is not manufactured in Mauritius, the swimwear fabric rather, that before didn't meet the rules of origin, now do meet the rules of origin. So these are new types of products that we are able to export in the EU. And we would like to be able to maybe make maximum use of the regional value chains. I'll come back to that a bit later because there are some constraints in using the regional value chains. As I mentioned before, the interim EPA provides for several areas of cooperation, and we would like to find some proper mechanism to make sure that all these chapters that are in the EPA are actually implemented. It's a bit small, but again, challenges that we face, a lot of them are internal. We have seen that it's only the main sectors that are still exporting. We haven't had seen major new sectors emerge. We would like to address that. There's low volume of exports from SMEs. SMEs find it difficult to access the EU markets. They have different constraints that the big ones don't have, whether it be standards, market intelligence, trade intelligence, cost to meet the market requirements. So these are things that we would like to see addressed. And also, they don't have probably enough support for the new SME and SMEs and also new exporters. So these are things that are internal, but I'm sure can be addressed both under the EPA as well. And at the external, we can see that the EU market is becoming more and more competitive for our exporters. Preferences are less and less important. It's true that tariffs are not so much an advantage now. So special textile, 10%. Maybe on children, 24% is important, but on textile, now it's really about other factors than tariffs. And of course, increased competitive pressure from some LDCs, from East Asia, from Southeast Asia. So the market is very, very competitive. So there's a constant pressure on our industries to stand out of the lot. EPA in the region, some of the challenges that we think in using regional value chain is how to link the different EPAs. There are three to four EPAs that we could use in the African region. Given that the region is divided and there are specific provisions under the EPA under which you can accumulate origin, and as at to now, we cannot accumulate origin with other EPAs. You need to have a specific MOU between the customs to be able to accumulate. So this is something that should be addressed as, I would think, as quickly as possible. I understand that recently there has been an SUP initiative for a joint undertaking to be able to accumulate origin among the different EPAs. So unless this is done, the use of regional value chains may not be, we might not be able to take the most advantage of it. Those that are in customs, I'm sure, will be able to expand a bit more on it. Second, the differences in the rules of origin between the REC rules and the EPA rules sometimes can be to a disadvantage. So you can export to the EU with simpler rules, but with the region with more difficult rules, sometimes we need to make more some common sense out part of it and see how what works best for the industry. You know, restrictive rules doesn't necessarily work best for the industry. So this is something that maybe we need to look at a bit in the long term. This is something that's dear to me, the different funds that are available in the region. In the EPA and Cotonou, there are so many funds available in the region. We talk about the EDF, the EPA fund, and there seems to be a lack of awareness from private sector institutions, whether it's national or regional, about how to use these different funds, how to submit projects, how to build projects. And I would like to see private sector institutions, especially private sector institutions in the region, submit projects on behalf of all chambers. And this is something that we don't see and we don't know how to address, because unfortunately, private sector institutions in the region are relatively weak because they depend on the chamber and then they rotate and we don't have a proper structure. And this is something that we can address. I don't know how, with SAIIA or otherwise, but it's something that, probably we need to, address. And also at national level, see how we can do some capacity building for chambers or private sector institutions to submit national projects as well, to consolidate institutions or even to encourage exports or whatever. Last, in terms of areas of collaboration, I thought of a few things, but I think the main thing would be facilitating trade. There could be regional projects. I mean, based on input that we had from operators, the biggest constraints when trading into the region relates to port efficiency, clearing goods can take 2 weeks, and submitting documents to couple multiple agencies at the same time. These are things that can be problems that are already addressed, but maybe you can find ways of accelerating some of these projects. And lastly, ideally, we would like to have a platform where all private sectors speak with one voice, which we cannot see and which we cannot hear either. So private sector coordination of actions, of vision, or of coherence, we cannot hear it at all in the region. This is something, a weakness that we can see. I don't know whether it would depend on the regional institution or who should drive it, but this is a reflection for me that, needs to be, taken in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Uma, for that insightful presentation. A very, positive picture of, results of concluding the EPA. Of course, you mentioned that one of the reasons you moved to conclude is that you didn't have a choice, and this is one of the reasons probably why other countries are more the LDCs, because of their preferences have been slow to concluding because they have a choice. SADC EPA group did also conclude EPA negotiations, and I would invite Munisiwe Tando to speak to that.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. My presentation is going to be very short. I don't have a slide presentation. I just got to know of this when I got here, so I didn't prepare much. Be that as it may, one wants to highlight the importance of the EPAs for Swaziland, specifically within the SADC group. For us, there was a bit of panic when there was a stalemate in concluding those negotiations. It was for us, that is our major market, particularly for our sugar, our beef, our some fruit, canned fruit and other fruit. So when there was that stalemate, we really felt that we were vulnerable as a country. As it is now, we are happy that that agreement was finally signed, even if it is an interim arrangement. We are looking at it as a source of economic growth for the country. In respect of, we hope that there will be more foreign direct investment coming to Swaziland. But of course, the challenges that remain are challenges that are linked to other areas other than trade. And once those become dominant, then the whole picture gets clouded. Because I am aware that now, as we speak, the EU is asking Swaziland to comply to a lot of different things which are outside of this agreement. And we know that it's going to affect the agreement and the things that were, and the trade that is currently going on. We are looking at EU as a continuous market for us, because we have not explored perhaps other areas where we could trade and maximize trade in terms of agreements. At this juncture, the private sector feels a little bit left out when it comes to preparation for these negotiations on the agreements. I know that specific members of the private sector are roped in by the government, but when the agreements come out, nobody then takes the initiative to come and say, private sector, this is it that has been agreed. And now these are the opportunities. And at this point, I'm aware that we're only utilizing a few of those benefits that come with the agreement. Not because maybe the private sector does not want to utilize, but perhaps out of ignorance of what is contained in those agreements. So I am seeing the private sector having a role to look into those agreements and unpack those agreements and see what other areas we can benefit from. We recently lost AGOA for reasons that are, well, I don't want to say linked to trade per se, very political reasons, but we lost it. And I'm looking at this going forward. EU may also be saying, if you don't comply to those certain, let me say, worldwide agreed practices, then obviously Swaziland is going to lose out. So I think that the picture at this moment is not a very bright one, but for the private sector. And it is unfortunate that it is the private sector that usually feels the brunt when these things happen, unfortunately. So our discussions at the moment are with government to say, look, let's correct things that we need to correct to be able to benefit from these agreements, because without the agreements, then we lose a whole lot of other things. I think that is my intervention at this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation, noting that you've had to do this upon arrival. Of course, whatever trade negotiations that are taking place, it's about business. At the end of the day, it's interaction of private sector activities. I also note that, of course, there are these other non-trade issues that play a role on trade agreements. Even certain preferences have limitations which are non-trade. These are some of the things that we have to grapple with in order to enhance our trade. I'll now have Charles to discuss the two presentations you have made. Charles?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The presentation that Ruma did, she has more or less touched on the situation of the EPA and the process of the negotiations and what we got of it and what is still outstanding for negotiations. And but in the context of the EPA negotiations, we have found out that during the process, some countries had, in fact, the private sector engaged. Two were Mauritius and Seychelles. Seychelles and Mauritius, when we were engaging, being on technical level, regional level, and the EU, we had the private sectors and Chamber of Commerce alongside us. And the whole interim EPA was concluded and signed with the presence and the cooperation of the private sector. And the challenges that we had was EU setting standards that was high and was forcing, for example, us Seychelles to bring in those standards, to do amendments to our domestic laws and regulations to ensure that we are up there. But for us Seychelles, it was a good thing in a way, as we were in the process of acceding to the WTO. Anyhow, we had to do these changes. We had to upgrade these laws. And that's the WTO and the EPA. So now, the opportunities that Roma has pointed out, it has only spilled into Seychelles. We have seen some sectors benefiting from the perspective of the EPA, and today they are exporting to the EU. We have an alcohol factory that is based in Seychelles, and now they are exporting not only to the EU but to the other regions of, let's say, Australia. They're exporting to South Africa, they're exporting to in Dubai duty free. You can see Seychelles product there, and they are trying to penetrate the US market. And but the difficulties we faced in terms of this whole EPA negotiation, like I said, is EU setting standards and the incoherence that we faced. For example, all fishing vessels, personers fishing in Seychelles today are EU personers. So when it comes to the rules of origin, polyobtain, definition of their vessels, it's not a problem for, I believe, Mauritius also and Seychelles. But the incoherence comes in when we have the Seychelles registered, Seychelles owned vessels, where they are wooden decks. And EU technical regulations do not allow the export of fish into the EU if they are caught on wooden deck vessels. But at the same time, EU, they have wooden deck vessels that are catching salmon, mackerel, sardines, and these are in circulation in the EU. Why not a Seychelles flag vessel that has a wooden deck? Anyway. And well, advantages of assigning the EPA, I'll mix up the advantages and disadvantages, because as I was taking note of the presentation, we have maintained market access. As you know, and the expiration of the Cotonou Agreement, the goods part, Seychelles would have lost out in terms of its tuna, canned tuna, penetrating the EU market, as we are a non-LDC. And the LDCs that was part of the configuration of the EPA, they could still go under the everything but arms, and the non-LDCs, we would lose out. So what we did, I would call it in a way of desperation. We had no choice. We had to break away from the ESA configuration and call ourselves CMNS, Comores, Mauritius, Madagascar, Seychelles. And we negotiated an EPA with the EU. And Seychelles liberalized 97.8% of its, well, will liberalize by 2022, 97.8% of its market to the EU. And we have managed to reserve an exclusion list. But challenges that we will face, even though we have an agreement with the EU, is the emerging mega trading blocks that the EU is negotiating with the US and EU-US with the Asia Pacific and so on. When it comes to canned tuna, as you know, Philippines, Taiwan, and the rest, they are exporting canned tuna to the EU. But on a quota of, I think they pay 24% into the EU, a quota of 12%. Now, if those mega trading blocks do come a reality, and they will press Philippines, Taiwan, and the rest, will press the EU to open markets, quota free, duty free, as they are giving to the ACP member states, this is where we will lose out. As the cost of productions in small, vulnerable islands, economies, is very high. Seychelles imports about 97% of what we consume, be it raw material, be it fossil fuel for energy, and we import some labor, and everything is imported. And the cost of freight is also high from Seychelles to Africa, to our neighboring islands, to EU. And so we have no other choice but to look at other markets. And that is the, sorry if I digress a little bit, because this presentation that I've done in the mornings, so it has an impact on those small island economies. Like in the tripartite negotiation, you see some countries maintaining and trying to preserve their dominant position in market in Africa. And it is tough, it is hard. for us to try to convince them that we need market access also in the tripartite. And one issue is the rules of origin, which has not been able to materialize in the tripartite and is still in the negotiations. Now, the rules of origin also is an issue in the discussions under the EPA, like Roma has pointed out. When it comes to accumulation, they have restrictions. If you want to accumulate with other recipient member states, that recipient member states must have signed an EPA with the EU. Then you need to embark onto a customs cooperation agreement and other issues. And well, basically that's what I can think of in terms of the difficulties and privileges of us signing an EPA with the EU and the threats that we are facing with all the trading blocks that are coming up. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your comments, Charles. Tuto, now we have a situation in the SADC region where some member states have obviously not signed the EPA, and then there's this issue of accumulation. You can't accumulate with other SCP countries, which Ruma has raised. How does this impact on this interaction between the SADC EPA group as well as the larger SADC region? You have the floor.
Okay. Thank you, Your Excellency, for this chance. Before I start, I want to say that I have my background in customs, but certainly I'm not that type which harassed women. The colleague said in the morning. I think I want to also thank presenters who came before me from the morning and just now. I think because I think this will be just a compliment to some of the discussions that we have had. In this particular presentation, we will try to look at a number of things, from rules of origin, competition for market access, overlapping memberships, and maybe some aspects of global cooperation as well. There's a lot has been said, I think, already with regard to the situation now about how far SADC has gone into trade intensity, regional integration. So I'm not going to touch a lot on that anymore, but a lot more details will come up in the detailed paper that I also prepared for ICTSD. So one of the points of departure, of course, was also some of the objectives that the SADC region has in terms of where they want to go in respect of regional integration, which include issues of wanting to liberalize trade, of course, wanting to have efficient production that takes care of current and dynamic comparative advantages, and also wanting to set up a free trade agreement. We have heard a lot about that. So the discussion will center more around the two EPAs, the interim ESA EPA and the SADC EPA. Also, I think here we will try to make some analysis, but it is acknowledged that in practice, some of the aspects will still need to be checked for the reality, because the analysis will differ then from product to product, sometimes from country to country. And I must also say that the views I'm going to express here are those that I have in my private capacity and not of the Research Revenue Authority, which I also work for. Right. First, let us talk about the question of the possible impact from the point of view of market access, competition for market access that could result maybe as a result of the airbus. The fact is that when if you go into the airbus, there is no obligation for SADC member states to extend the preferences that they extend to their regional partners to the EU. But of course, trade will be liberalized vis-à-vis the EU. And in order for us to examine all of that, we want to look at three aspects. First, we'll check what is the intention under the EPAs to liberalize trade vis-à-vis what has been the intention also in the SADC under the SADC trade protocol. And then we will try to channel the message to say, are we going to have a situation where EU products will compete with SADC products in the SADC market? And then we will try to look at whether this has potential for increasing intra-SADC trade. I mean, this will be the concept that we try to demonstrate throughout the presentation. So if you just have a quick look in the provisions of the three regimes, everyone is saying all import tariffs will be eliminated and so on, but of course we all know that there will always be some exceptions. So to that end, we're at least able to see that what the ambition is in respect of SADC and as well as the EPAS. On the question of whether there is likelihood of EU products competing with SADC products in the SADC market, the situation we have here, the illustration is so that we can maybe look at two SADC countries whereby there is a certain product being traded, and then this product is also liberalized vis-à-vis the EU under the EPAS. So you realize that now the possibility will be that once that happens, then the EU light product could compete with that. But of course, this is just a theoretical explanation where we are saying if there was no liberalization of the EU light product, then there would be no competition. But with the EU light product being liberalized, then there could be competition. But let us have a look at a few examples. I was hoping it would look better than this, on the table that you see, these are just some examples of some of the products that seem to be traded. It is from the top 10 list of commodities that are traded within SADC on the import side. Products in these are harmonized system chapters. Minerals, 84, machinery, and so on. The list goes on. Then, if we look at whether in liberalization, are these products, are there any products in these categories that have been excluded from liberalization? Then then there was an analysis that was done, and then we picked up some examples from the list of Madagascar under the interim EU EPA, because otherwise you would have to do it for all the countries. So these are just examples. So in that analysis, coming out of those categories, six, because we took 10, six of them, it had looked like then there would be no competition from EU products, because they are excluded from liberalization. And therefore, in that case, it means the better option would be in the SADC market. For four of those, then there will be competition from the EU light products, because under the EPAS, the same products have been liberalized because there are no exclusions. What is the point that we are making here? The point we are making is that, yes, there is no obligation for the EPA countries to extend regional preferences to the EU, but it would look like, of course, there are possibilities on both sides, that there will be products which will be liberalized and therefore create competition for light products in the SADC market. At the same time, there are those that will be excluded, and therefore in that case, there will be no competition for certain goods. That is the point we are making with regard to the possible market access impact. Let us proceed now to look at the rules of origin impact possibility. Again, before I go into the practical examples, let us look at the formula. We need to ask ourselves to say, if we look at the rules of origin, then which market between the SAIIA one and the EU market will the rules attract exporters to? In other words, we will look at, we will have to compare the two rules of origin for the same products and say, okay, which ones will be easier for the exporters to fulfill, because that is where you can expect people to export to if they are able to meet the conditions. That being said, then we look at, we also took some examples again from the top 10 products, but this time we looked at exports. This list, of course, is those products that we are saying, according to the statistics from the SAIIA website, are the ones that are already being traded more than others, intra-SAIIA. So another sort of assumption that has been made here is that the change of tariff heading based rules generally could be considered to be easier than the value-based ones. But it doesn't mean in reality in all the cases that will be the situation, because we will have to double check everything in reality. Then in the analysis of the 10 products that we did, when you compare the rules of origin, you will find that 6 of those 10 products favored SAIIA as export destination. Why? Because the conditions to meet inside the rule are better than those you have to meet as an exporter under the EPA rule. And 3 of those favor the EU market. For one rule, the rule had the same conditions. What does that mean? This means that there is also, again, similarly to the market access issue, there is there are possibilities on both sides to say, for certain products, we can expect that SAIIA exporters will find it easier to export within the SAIIA. But it is also clear that for others, then it will be much more attractive to export to the EU because of, simply based on those conditions. So I want you to realize one thing, that every time we deal with analysis, for example, on rules of origin, we forget a little bit about the other aspects, because in reality, it's a mix of all these things. But just so that we can see the possible impact, we analyze separately. And then we look at the question of cumulation. In this case, we're going to look at two dimensions. The first dimension is where we are talking about what we are currently able to export within the region, and then look at how that could further be exploited once the EPAs come into force. Then the other aspect, we look at issues of exclusions, but I will talk about that later. Let's talk about the one where we are saying we are already trading on these products more than others, and what will then happen? So this is just to illustrate, to make an example, to say, considering two SAIIA states which are trading in a certain product, which is an input into a product produced in the other states. So here you'll find the SAIIA 2, the SAIIA 1, and just for illustration purposes. So if the EPA, before the EPAs come into force, maybe the state which is importing materials from another SAIIA state, maybe the production is just for local consumption, okay? But then once you introduce the EPAs, you will realize that now the EPAs, as long as there's going to be trade between this state and the EU, there will probably be more demand of products of the other SAIIA state that will become inputs for final goods going to the EU. And that will probably expand trade, because we are no longer looking at local consumption in this state. So that is the logic. And based on that, we looked at also, again, the same products that we looked at in the previous example of rules of origin. to say, okay, fine, let us take some products from these categories as well, some more specific ones, and say, looking at the Airbus, will accumulation be possible in this case? And how do we look at that? We try to look at whether in the exclusion list for accumulation, some of these products will appear. Then for all the examples that were made, none of the products appeared in the exclusion list. It gives us an impression that then for those products that we see, there will be possibility to accumulate. In other words, then we can be able to exploit the opportunity based on the accumulation provisions. Now, it is also a fact that some products have been excluded from accumulation, and especially with certain countries. And I want to pick up especially accumulation in South Africa. It was reported in the other presentations earlier that South Africa is dominating intra-Saharan trade. I think even in the paper, that detailed paper, this also has been picked up. So now let us make that example of South Africa and then see, because if here, it's just to explain the concept again to say, without the EPA, the same situation as the previous one would prevail, where imports are from the other SAIIA states, and then there is production for local market only. But once the EPA is coming in, but then there is exclusion of products from South Africa from accumulation. Remember, South Africa currently is the one that's dominating. Then, without accumulation with South Africa, it could now mean that the demand will divert from South African products. I mean, this is theoretically speaking, from South African products to maybe other states within SAIIA, for which accumulation is allowed. So, based on that logic, then we had a look also at some of the exclusions that appear under the APAs. The SAIIA EU EPA does not have specific list as yet, because only a principle is embedded to say, for example, products that do not enter the EU duty-free will not be allowed for accumulation. So at the moment, you would need to go into very detailed analysis to check which ones are those. But at least for the interim SAIIA EPA, there is a specific list in one of the annexes to say which products are not allowed for accumulation in South Africa. And these include agricultural products, basic agricultural products, and so on. So one thing that could be drawn from this is that where accumulation is excluded from South Africa, this, as much as it could maybe on face value look like it's a bad thing, it could create opportunities for the small economies in South Africa. Could take advantage of that to create other industries or explore or expand existing ones. I remember when the colleague from Swaziland mentioned about the panic they had about some of their products, like canned fruit. That's one of the areas that could be explored in this regard. The messages that we can get here is that it looks like there will be possibilities for further exploiting current comparative advantages that we have based on the products we are already trading more than others. We can further exploit that based on accumulation. But on another hand, we can also look at an opportunity that could arise from the exclusion list of products, especially from South Africa. And we can look at opportunities in agriculture, fisheries, aluminium, as per the list of products. Let us now proceed to look at overlapping memberships. The issue with overlapping memberships, we know that at the moment, SAIIA member states have memberships in a number of different regional setups. Now, the EPAs, what will happen is that when the EPAs come in, they will not necessarily dismantle that. They will now introduce some new elements, because, you know, with overlapping memberships, the problem is that there will be now contradictions when one country is a member of one or more regimes or regional economic communities. There will be contradictions on some of the provisions. So when the EPAs come in, we will see now on this picture that the circles indicate the current setup that we know. And the colors, the countries that are that have been colored in yellow, for example, are those that are in the commercial related EPA. The countries colored in red are those that are in the SAIIA related EPA. The ones in green are those that are in the EAC related EPA. So the EPAs now will bring even more possibilities for contradictions, contradicting provisions now, because you will see now that one of them will be in the commercial related EPA, but is also a member of SAIIA. So there are possibilities again there of contradicting commitments. So here are some of the examples of the possible contradiction effects. If you look at, let's start on the top left in the part in the circle. We indicate here that SAIIA states are negotiating the EPAs in different configurations. We know that has been mentioned. This, because then these EPAs will become independent legal instruments. They are not, it's not unlike in the Cotonou where there was a single regime, they are not independent from each other. That means they will not be implemented at the same time necessarily. And some of the issues that are required for implementation, I think maybe I'll talk about that in another portion there. But on this one, then it means we could take long before we start benefiting from accumulation because of that. On the top right corner, we are saying that accumulation requires certain cooperation agreements. Here, you will realize that if we go country by country to have these cooperation agreements, I think our colleagues mentioned it, it will be very costly. Therefore, it will be a problem. The other thing is that when I think we have already passed that analysis where we compared rules of origin between SAIIA and the EPAs. We saw that in some cases they are different. So if the rules of origin are different, imagine that there was already a product that was being traded between two SAIIA states. And now the rule of origin of the EPA is simpler, is better than the SAIIA one. This could then, now, even for products that were already traded, it could now divert that, because people will now want to look at where rules of origin are simpler. So you would see that now the EPAs now will bring some more contradiction effects, and therefore we could have some problems because of it could exacerbate this problem of overlapping memberships. And that's what we are saying, is that the overlapping nature of the EPA configurations will make it difficult for SAIIA to benefit from accumulation. And also we could experience diversions of trade from even products that we were already trading in. We are moving on to development cooperation now, to look at which areas are possible, which sectors are considered, what are the mechanisms that exist. I think the previous speakers touched on that as well, really. We'll try to go with a bit of high speed on this one. This was just to indicate that, because as I indicated, one of the objectives was to make sure there's efficient production. So there are those, as examples, areas that are to be covered, including infrastructure, productive capacities. So hopefully this will be able to answer to some of the problems that the private sector have already raised. And with mechanisms like those that are financial and those that are non-financial, we can hope that maybe something better will come out of that. There is also provision for prioritizing LDCs, which is a good indicator. So a number of mechanisms exist. I don't want to be elaborate on this one. If we were to move to the continental level, because I think the other intention here was also to look at what then would be the implications of the EPAs if we go to the larger context. this will be the kind of picture that we would have, but it is, as you can see, it's going to be very, very complicated. So now, we look at the various aspects again to say what are the likelihoods. From the market access point of view, we saw the analysis. And I think that here we are saying the continental FTA will open doors for more inter-REC trade. That means it could be better to open more markets with other African countries from that point of view. So that we can try to strengthen further the competitiveness of African products vis-a-vis the EU ones. From the rules of origin point of view, we should not expect rules of origin to be more stringent because of their key principle. I think in the tripartite FTA negotiations, that principle is embedded. So if it can be used, it means we should not expect our rules of origin to be any stricter, which could be a positive indicator. Accumulation, we are saying if as long as there is accumulation possibilities and we go into the continental FTA, opening up to the continental at the continental level can bring more benefits on the accumulation side. But remember, of course, we raised some possible challenges as well. On the upper level membership side, that one is not going to be resolved automatically because, as I said, the efforts are going to be to bring some more contradictions possibilities. Development cooperation could be useful because then that we can start looking at opportunities for joint projects, inter-REC projects, especially on trade facilitation. I think we saw very good progress on some of the RECs in that regard. So if we want to ask ourselves which sectors will carry more potential than others, well, it could be a subject even for further studies. But just on the picture that we saw here, we saw that there are already groups of products that are traded more than others. This would include those ones that are listed: petroleum, precious stones, machinery. I had my colleague from Russia's machine jewelry. We have heard about, I think, South Africa maybe exporting motorcycles. So this is as per the statistics. These ones could be considered, especially for exploiting further the chances for accumulation. On the other hand, we could also look at those sectors for which there are exclusions from accumulation and take advantage for the smaller economies. In agriculture, fisheries, infrastructure, aluminium. Okay, then of course I think these ones would also resonate to some of the suggestions that were made. In market access, we need to do some detailed assessments, rules of origin simplify, try to look at privacy sectors for accumulation, take care of the overlapping membership issues to try and harmonize and take care of the development cooperation, take advantage of development cooperation. Well, in conclusion, really, I think it's just to say we have seen that there is still a lot of room for SAIIA to move on. The EPAS could have positive and negative impact. Market access, we saw that there will be possibilities on both sides. Rules of origin need to be simplified. Accumulation, we will have a lot of challenges unless we deal with them. And really, I think we have already made most of the points. But let me just talk to the next steps to say maybe we need a common platform at SAIIA level to start identifying these priorities together and looking at offensive and defensive interests so that we don't lose what we have already in our hands and try to explore some new possibilities. I would like to stop there. I'm sure I took a lot of time. Hopefully it's not too late. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Soto, and thank you for a very comprehensive presentation. From what I could pick, I mean, with liberalization as a result of concluding the EPA. For me, it boils down to our need to increase competitiveness, because even if we talk about preferences, there's bound to be some erosion as a result of mega regionals coming up and so forth, continued FTA negotiations globally, will amount to erosion. So we'll need to increase our competitiveness. And this links into what Christopher should be presenting ago, and its implication for SADC trade. As you are aware, in May this year, the US Senate voted to extend the AGOA for the next 10 years. But of course, this is a unilateral preference scheme. So we need to be aware that it is not really the future. The future is increasing competitiveness.
Thanks very much, Chair. I think you really hit the nail on the head there when you're speaking about the fact that it remains a unilateral preference, but the question really is for how much longer? This is the first AGOA of the EPA age, and I think the linkages between the two is very important, and it's good to have the two in the same session, I think. Because really, during the process of signing AGOA, which of course is very acrimonious because of a whole range of reasons, what you consistently heard was that there is this question that is raised by the Americans about why should they have a unilateral preference given to Africa when the Europeans have two-way access, have a full trade deal. And you very much get the sense that the Americans are increasingly looking towards the future to having something similar to the EPAs. And I think the last presentation really brilliantly highlighted how complex just having one set of large free trade agreements with the developed world can be. And if AGOA starts turning into these preferences, it's going to raise a whole lot of other challenges. And I think more importantly, it's also going to raise the question of what this deal will look like in 10 years' time. Will all of us have American access to the American market? Will AGOA be renewed at all? And these questions, the moving timeline, mean that our response to AGOA really has to be set up to take advantage of this moment right now. This is really the last 10 years that we're absolutely sure that we're going to have good AGOA preferences without having to give up anything in return. And this is an opportunity that really has to be capitalized on. So I'm going to talk about three things, really. First of all, I'm just going to give an overview of AGOA thus far and how successful or otherwise it's been. Then I'm going to look at why it hasn't succeeded quite to the potential that is on offer. And then finally talk about some possible ideas about how to improve usage of AGOA. So I'll go through those three things. So this is the big picture. This is the overall trend of AGOA trade compared to a bunch of other trends. I'm sure it's difficult to read. But basically, the big thick blue line is AGOA's growth since it was signed in the early, or the end of 2000. And it's compared to a bunch of trends with the rest of the world. The dotted purple line is the trend within African exports, of exports to the emerging world, particularly to the BRICS countries. And as you can see, compared to that, it's obviously not doing as well, but nothing's really doing quite as spectacularly as the BRICS and African trade is there. But in general, compared to the US, in the general trend in US imports, which is the red line, and the AGOA group's exports to the EU, AGOA has done okay. It hasn't been a disaster. It's allowed exports to continue above trend for a little while, at least in this big picture overview. It's dipped below that trend at the very end because of deflated oil prices. But in general, AGOA hasn't been terrible in terms of this big picture. Where its actual challenges lie, and where we really have to start addressing, is once you get a little bit more into the details, particularly about the division of benefits within AGOA between countries and between sectors. So this is AGOA within countries. And again, it's a bit difficult to read. The blue line at the bottom is South Africa's exports to the US. The red line is Angola's exports to the US, and the green line in the middle is Nigeria's. And as you can see, and Chad is just above that, those four countries really dominate a lot of the AGOA trade to South Africa, to the United States, sorry. And really, this picture I don't think captures quite how bad that polarization actually is. What really captures it is the fact that half of AGOA-eligible countries send less than $1 million worth of goods to the United States. Those countries have access to AGOA and access to the US on paper, but in real terms of trade actually happening, they are not part of this deal, and they have not been brought into it. So really, getting those laggards into the deal would be one of the most powerful things we can do here. Now, obviously, with these trends, it's pretty clear, I think, what is actually being traded. Look at that big dominance of Nigeria, Angola, and Chad, and it's very unsurprising that oil is overwhelmingly what is sent under AGOA. The big blue line that's dominating that entire graph is oil, and it's decreasing at the end there, but that's not a positive picture. That's just because the oil price is going down. It doesn't reflect any real diversification. Above it as well, the red bar that you see there is mineral exports. So again, it's commodities. And it's only once you get to the green line, which is automotives, that you get a little bit of diversification. Now, this is a problem. It's a problem for three reasons. First of all, because the benefits of exporting oil really are limited. There are benefits, of course. It brings in lots of money to a country, it empowers the government, but it also just isn't particularly well spread out in terms of broad-based benefits of growth. So that isn't a particularly beneficial time to trade. It also just, of course, on the second level, reflects that we're not taking advantage of all the options on the table. There's a whole lot of product lines that could be traded with the US under AGOA. I think in total, there's 10,500 US tariff lines in total. And under AGOA, a country like South Africa will have access to 9,000 of those with all the other zero-rated tariff lines. So there's huge opportunities. And if we're just using it for oil, we're not taking advantage of it to the maximum capacity. But really, the biggest problem is that oil doesn't follow trade preferences. Trade preferences are not important for the distribution of the trade of oil and heavy commodities. Countries and firms tend to buy this because they have to. And if there is any political or decision-making, trade decision-making involved, it's normally because of safety issues, trying to make sure that you have a secure source of oil that's diversified. So this isn't really AGOA doing this. It isn't AGOA driving that oil trade. It's just the fact that the US needs oil. So this is a big problem, this lack of diversification. Again, this is taking out that oil and just looking at what has been happening. So there are a couple of emerging diversified trades. The green line, for example, is vehicle trade. Textiles are is the orange line, which has gone a little bit up and down, but has been beneficial to places like Lesotho, Mauritius, countries I think that Vinay spoke about this morning. So there are some trends, but nothing quite on the scale of what we've seen with oil. This is again taking out oil, and this is again the problem with that diversified picture, is that if we remove oil from the country, from the trade figures, these are the major countries that are trading, and as you can see, South Africa is overwhelmingly dominant. The green line that we saw in the previous graphs of automotive exports overwhelmingly come from South Africa. So if we remove oil, the benefits of AGOA become even more concentrated. So as you can see, AGOA, it hasn't been a disaster in terms of the big picture about how much we trade with the US, but it has been problematic in terms of what is traded and which countries benefit from that trade. So why is this happening? Why is AGOA not lived up to expectations? Really, it's because of three categories of forces, I'd say. The first is some big macro trends. AGOA and the signing of AGOA, the creation of AGOA really coincided with the rise of a lot of major emerging countries in Asia, which brought in a whole heap of competition at the very moment that South Africa and Africa had access to this market. And the best indication of that is if you look at Mexico. Mexico is a very dynamic emerging economy with a very established trade relationship with the US and better access in terms of trade under NAFTA than we have under AGOA. And yet in 2005, the Mexican textile industry that was reliant on trade with the US market was more or less destroyed by the entry of China and lots of emerging countries when they gained access after the end of protections after the multi-fiber agreement ended. So even a country like Mexico, which has a much closer relationship to the US and a much more established trade pattern, wasn't able to resist some of the changes that came about once you had greater entry of the likes of China into the market. So that's one trend we really couldn't, I guess, do much about. The second trend is really to do with AGOA itself and how it's set up. And really there are three issues here. The first is that there are still limitations on what tariff lines and what the remaining tariff restrictions to get into the US. There are about 1,500 lines on which we still face protections when entering the US market. And that's on things like tobacco, groundnuts, dairy products, a whole range of things that Africa could potentially send. So there remain tariff barriers. The second, and I think perhaps the more difficult problem in terms of protectionism, is that there's huge constraints outside of tariffs. There's massive subsidies in the US, particularly for agriculture goods, that make it particularly difficult for African countries to enter into the market, particularly with the renewal of the Farm Bill, which provides massive support to US producers and keeps a lot of imports out of the market. And then the third problem was really some restrictions on rules of origins. There have been some progress made on this, particularly on textiles. The rules of origin, which has kind of been a theme that we've all been discussing, remained a problem with AGOA as well. Now, those two big trends, the macro trend about emerging countries entering and the US is setting up or go in certain ways, there's really nothing we can do about that to a large extent. Can't have changed the macro trend of the existence of China. And given the politics of the US Parliament, it's very difficult to affect change in how a go has been written, except at the margins. But what there really can be things done about are the two major causes of a GOA not living up to expectations within Southern Africa and within Africa. And those are as follows. So the first is that tariffs, as has been said before in this conference, just aren't that important as a restriction to trade. They help that there's no tariffs. No one wants a tariff when you're trying to trade out, but they're certainly not the major driving force. So these are the major constraints that companies complain about. The light blue line is 2009's, this is a survey data, light blue line is 2009, dark blue line is 2012, I think. But basically these are the big constraints that they face. And as you can see in the yellow line, tariffs do come up there, but they're not the most important things. So a lot of the things that we've been speaking about in terms of regional integration, or in terms of taking advantage of the efforts, they come across here. It's getting this basic stuff right, like transport costs, making sure that there's a relatively stable exchange rate, making sure that we are competitive, as our chairman just said at the beginning. And really getting these things right are preconditions to taking advantage of the tariff access that comes with COA. You have to get that right as a basis in order to compete, particularly when you're facing increased competition from emerging Asia and places like that. But then I think this is really the big thing, is that there has to be some kind of diversified economic base in order to take advantage of COA. This graph here is South Africa's trade with the United States, South Africa's exports to the United States. And South Africa really has benefited quite a lot under GOA, and in a much more diversified way. The red line, I think, are automotive exports from South Africa, and similarly, the purple line is machinery. So it's a much more diversified picture than you see with the European Union, for example, and is really, it's been described by the South African government as our rising sun relationship, because it's the type of trade relationship based on processed goods that we would really like to see in the future for South Africa. But of course, South Africa is not like the rest of the continent. It's a country that has the basics of a diversified economic base, and it's that difference that has allowed it to take advantage of this in this more powerful way. So the question really is how to recreate these types of situations in countries that don't already have diversification. How to make small segments of diversified economic bases that allow you to take. And of course, the big problem with diversification is that although it will probably happen at some time in the future, in the case of a GOA, it has to happen to quite a strict timeline. You have this 10-year limit of the renewal now that you can be certain of, and after that, there's a lot of uncertainty. Will the deal be renewed in its current form, or will it be some kind of new deal like an effort? And even if there is a renewed deal, how beneficial will a GOA benefits really be when the US also gives market access to the likes of Malaysia, Vietnam, and other countries in the main regionals and Trans-Pacific Partnership and Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership? So once you have this erosion of your preferences, how do you remain competitive? How do you take advantage of that? And what that means is that our response to try and diversify can't be a grand vision of diversification in 50 years' time. It has to be low-level, rapid diversification in certain levels now. Or at least that's how I would see it. So this is it. So capitalizing on GOA, how do we actually take advantage of this within the short time period? And the centrality of diversification, I guess with that, it's really widespread benefits. So of course it would grow a GOA US trade, it would grow the benefits because you spread the sectors that are benefiting and you move it into more labor intensive sectors, for example. But it also can drive regional integration. If you have some level of diversification and you start producing a little bit of manufactured goods, then you create scope for other countries to, you create scope to create value chains, basically. You're not going to have a value chain if you're just sending exports straight, just sending oil straight to the US. But if you're sending automotives like South Africa, there's some scope to allow for regional collaboration and to really tie into those value chains. So there's three potential strategies, and these are just throwing out ideas really that I came up with when writing the paper. So the first one, and I think the most established, is to really try and utilize the value chains that exist now and to try and make sure that when you're sourcing goods for the value chains that currently exist, you're using goods from neighboring African countries. And the perfect example of this, I think, is the South African automotive export sector. South African automotive exports have done relatively well, partly because of the GOA and partly because of a system of large-scale industrial support. but a lot of the component parts that are sourced are either sourced from within South Africa or from the equipment manufacturers within anywhere in the world, basically. But there isn't much trade within automotive goods within the region. There's some nascent trade patterns. For example, we buy wiring harnesses, things that bind wires together from Botswana. But really, there's huge scope to increase that. What they would need, I think, is a little bit of support in connecting South African producers with suppliers in the rest of the region, and also just making sure that the rules of origin and the trade patterns and the level of integration facilitate the inputs actually crossing the border. And of course, it would perhaps require some support to the component manufacturers to try and marry the industrial support for firearm exports in South Africa with component production in the rest of the continent. Then another idea, the second one there, is to perhaps use isolated zones, or GOA zones, basically export processing zones that focus on the US market. Now, export processing zones and special economic zones have been used extensively across the continent and don't have the best track record in Africa, but I don't think that means they're fundamentally bad. I think it just means that a lot of the time they haven't been implemented particularly well. If you look at the Asian region or the Mekong Delta or anywhere within East Asia really, the power of zones has been very effective. They have driven a lot of trade. And particularly in this case, I think they are very useful because of the timeline, because of the restrictions and how fast your response has to be. What these economic zones can do is they can create isolated geographic areas that mirror the diversified economy that we want to see in the future. So instead of having to change your entire economic structure to build a power supply that can reach the entire economy, for example, you can have generators supplied directly to the zones that allow for some level of stability. So instead of having to transform the entire country, you transform a single zone and make sure that that's targeted at the lower countries. So that's really about some way to play with this timeline and to have some response there. And then the third thing, the third recommendation is really about empowering cities and local governments to more effectively deal with trade promotion, which is something I think that a lot of us overlook. It's one of the big overlooked strategies that have been used within East Asia was the empowerment of local governments to change the way their city runs in relation to trade. And particularly here, I think, you know, we speak a lot about underdeveloped African countries, but none of these countries are homogenous. You have many cities that are world-class within African countries that are otherwise not particularly well-developed. And if you can use those cities to drive your trade patterns, then I think you can make a lot of progress. But that means empowering local governments and bringing them into trade discussions. We're often left on the sidelines for national governments to have that discussion. So those are three potential strategies. It will be challenging to have a diversified export basket with the United States. But really, I think if it's going to happen, or if the beginning of a diversified trade relationship with the US is going to happen, it's going to happen over the next 10 years. Because after that, you're going to have a very different set of preferences that probably won't be as good. So now is the moment to take action. I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Christopher. Really, this issue of AGOA has been a difficult one. Even, you know, the suggested strategies, one wonders whether a country could establish a zone, you know, start to manufacture, you know, out of the zone before the 10 years elapses. You know, it's a big challenge. Let's hear from Eric. Eric, your comments on Christopher's presentation.
Thank you. There, I'd say three or four things that were pointed out from Christopher's presentation, and that probably later we'll add the particular example of Madagascar to actually complement the presentation. The first thing is that this is the I would say the last opportunity that we have under this system. We have 10 years, and when you think 10 years, it's not actually that long. It's going to come fast, so we need to react as soon as possible. The second point is the way on how we can actually take or profit or benefit from the actual system. mainly to diversify the economy. And I'm going to come to that on the case of Madagascar later on. And Christopher has introduced to us the three strategies that may be applicable or maybe beneficial for us to address the issue. I'm talking about value chains, the AGOA zones, and the empowerment of the local government and cities. If I try to connect that these opportunities to the case of Madagascar, just a little bit of a background. Madagascar, we were eligible to AGOA back in 2000. And then from 2003 to 2008, our export in terms of textile to the US roughly doubled from $150 million to $300 million just on textile. That means it has been a great opportunity for us because it's I would say that the way we could boost the textile industry in Madagascar, and we lost it in 2009, and then we were back again a year ago. But just to confirm that it's still an opportunity, is that especially if I'm just talking about textile, today we know that the US, the Americans are the biggest consumers of t-shirt, if we're just talking about t-shirt. One American buys 7 t-shirts while one European would buy 1. And the market is evaluated at, just a t-shirt is evaluated at $170 billion, just a t-shirt. So it's still a lot of opportunities for the producers. In our specific case, we do not have all of the raw materials in Madagascar, but we, for example, we import fabrics from Mauritius, from India, from Pakistan, and other countries. It's under the third country fabric provision that we are allowed to do that. But still, it's, once again, it's a great opportunity. And that's about textile. Now, talking about diversification, in the case of Madagascar, we have about 6,000 items eligible to AGOA. But as of today, we just are relying solely on textile. What would be the opportunities for us and for SADC countries in that is, Christopher just talked about the restrictions, the norms and standards that are required when you ship something to the US. Probably each country has its specialty or its strengths on maybe technology or resources and things like that. It would be interesting to have an inventory of what each country can have and then try to access that market. And also having the inventory of all of these items. Christopher talked about more than 10,000 items in total, so once again, it's a great opportunity. Talking about this, the strategies, we've been helped, assisted by the USAID Trade Hub based in Botswana. They came to Madagascar not long ago and presented to us what can be other opportunities. They were really pushing us, beside textile, to look at the specialty food, for example, which I believe is specific to each country. Each country has its specific food and handicraft. Same thing for each country. It could be exploited by every country. And then they were also pushing for the home and deco. I think it would be something that can be exploited together amongst the SADC countries. And also the empowerment. Recently they invited or they sent to us people from the US Customs to give some trainings and capacity buildings to our custom people. In terms of that empowerment. And then the AGOA zone, we are just starting identifying actually the zones that could be set as an economic special zone for AGOA or for other activities, but we definitely are trying to snap up this opportunity so that we can have these last 10 years in our side, and I definitely would encourage that the SAIIA countries would look at what could be done together, joining the resources and joining all of the capacities to find ways to exploit this market. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric, for the comments and for some presentation on Madagascar. Of course, you know, the AGOA question continues to be a challenge. One would think that you know, in terms of diversification, it should be a long-term strategy, and obviously you can't diversify on the basis of a market which will expire in 10 years. One has to look at a more permanent market in order to invest fully in that diversification program. I'll now open the floor for Q&A, and I note Mike as I'll give you the floor, Mike, to start.
Can you hear me?
Definitely.
I've got 5 points to make, and I'll make them quickly. You're recording it. In that case, I'm not prepared to incriminate myself.
Never stopped you before.
I'll try and be quick, because I'll try and expand on some of these tomorrow. The thing that surprises me for a conference talking about regional integration in Southern Africa is that there hasn't been one mention of SAIIA, the South African Customs Union, and that surprises me no end. Because actually the source of, in clothing and textiles, the source of Lesotho and Swaziland being able to create regional value chains has been precisely through SAIIA and not through SADC or anything else. So that's the first point. The second point about, so the point about that is it's been about ownership that has been critical. It's about regional integration through investment. Regional integration, environment, trade, it's also about finance and investment. It's been about South African-owned firms locating in Swaziland and Lesotho, producing there to export back into South Africa in order to escape the South African labor market restrictions. That creates a problem, because the southern government doesn't actually like that. So that's the first point. The second point is, the Mauritian story is very interesting, because normally what you do is that you learn from regional trade allows you to learn to build your capabilities in order to be able to enter into global value chains and global markets. Mauritius is the exact opposite. Mauritius has learned by exporting to the EU and upgraded its clothing and textiles, and on that basis, same with Madagascar, on that basis has regionally integrated through trade and exported to South Africa. It's a very interesting reversal of what you would normally find, you know, in the literature. Quickly, once again, the question of regional investment is critical, because the role that Mauritius has played in Madagascar as Mauritian firms investing there has been important. So we should always look at regional investment and regional trade together. Third quick point. Chris, I'm afraid the possibility of entering auto value chains is a nice idea, but the standards that are required are so high that the only reason why the South African component manufacturing industry can do this is because of massive support from companies like Benchmarking and Manufacturing Analyst Justin Barnes that have helped firms to be able to meet the standards, to be able to export. So if you do that, if you try and do that in the region, you better be able to invest a lot in service providers who know about international competitiveness. The third thing about AGOA, fourth thing that I want to make about AGOA is that the problem with the US market is it's about big volumes, it's about low complexity, and it's not about upgrading. It's also about Asian investors, big transnational investors in the clothing and textile industry. It drives firms down the value chain and not up the value chain. Mauritius and Madagascar are a very good example of a clothing and textile industry that has upgraded and has moved into complexity on the back of not a goal, on the contrary, on the back of the EU and the South African market. The South African is an afterthought, but on the back of the EU market that wants shorter volumes, smaller volumes, batch production, and upgrading into more complex products. And the last final quick point is that I'm very surprised that people are making more emphasis upon agro-processing, because that I think is a real possibility of moving into diversified value-added types of activities, but I'll talk about that tomorrow. I'm sorry, Mr. Chair, I'll try to be as fast as I can.
No, Mike, those are very useful points that we'll quote here in our institution. Any other? Yes?
Thank you very much. Just a few quick points. I think it's important for us to realize that in relation to AGOA and the EPAs, the value of this arrangements now might not necessarily be the value 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line. I think the chair alluded to it. First of all, with regards to even the WTO, if at the WTO, duty-free, quota-free is granted to all LDCs, right, then it dramatically changes the usefulness of AGOA to everybody that is looking at clothing and textile exports to the US market, because then you'd be competing with Bangladesh, with Vietnam, and the value becomes completely different. If that also happens within the EU, then even the preferences that you have managed to negotiate within the EPAs also become much less valuable. That is not even to talk of the mega regional trade agreements that will still further erode these preferences. So what does this mean? It means that what we have now, we have a limited window to take advantage of it. And I think it brings us back to the importance of regional integration. The only element which you can somewhat control, right, is still your own regional or continental markets. And as such, the window for the continental free trade area, for the tripartite, and for the deepening of our markets, our own market structures, is extremely limited. Because I think, like Christopher said, this is going to be the last AGOA. After this, the US wants to negotiate reciprocal trading agreements. We do not see how AGOA will be renewed again under any circumstances. As such, in a way, charity begins at home, and without overflogging the issue, it is urgent for us to sort out our integration arrangements as quickly as possible.
I can see much more interest than the time we have. Malobe?
Yeah, thank you, sir. I thought our presenters would talk about China. Of course, Chris did, but I thought...
The next.
Yeah, I don't know what I'm going to say. Let me just say that. why were they able to erode our competitiveness when they entered AGOA? I think they said that conversation. Was it labor market? What was it? Was it wages? Was it where they remunerate employees? Let's just talk about that briefly. Or is it the next session? I think I'd like to hear that. Because everyone says, no, we can't compete with those guys. We can't compete with Bangladesh. Why not?
Yeah, I'll allow Christopher to respond to that before I move to the others. Christopher.
Oh, wait, just that one?
Yeah,
just that one. I mean, I think the easy answer is low labor costs, right? I mean, that's the go-to answer. But it is more complicated than that. I think it's about capacity for just-in-time production is very important, so your ability to respond to short-term demands or short-term fluctuations in input supply. I know just basic transport facility, transport costs, things like that. I mean, I'd say the big one is labor costs. But that being said, I don't think that's set. I don't think that's we're never going to be able to compete. You see the Ethiopia story arising and a little bit of competition coming through there. But it's just the point at which it happened. China was much more ready to take advantage of their low-cost labor. I think that's the point.
I have basically 4 minutes to get contributions. Wally. Please go ahead.
Maybe just a remark. Might just jump the gun talking about SAIIA. I was also wondering in the case of why do people concentrate on the SADC model and the commission model with these problems of overlapping membership? Why do you sort of allude to the SAIIA model? Because it works. With all these problems, it works better than the others. Even if you look at the IRPAS, which was discussed just a little bit earlier, the so-called SADC IRPA configuration consists basically out of two groups. One group is Mozambique on its own, and the SADC countries as a coherent entity on the other side. Thanks.
Thank you. Ina?
Thank you, Chair. Just a very quick comment. The whole idea of preferences is, and I hope you will agree with me, the whole idea is really to grow out of preferences, isn't it? When AGOA came in 2000, the idea was that it was going to be a short-term arrangement. Yeah? It was never meant to be something that will go on and on. So the idea really was to give countries a chance to export to the US, in the process learn, in the process build a competitiveness, so that once the preferences are removed, they can actually keep exporting to the US, not just to the US, but other countries as well. Now, what happened was, many countries, instead of, and I see, I heard Eric mentioning that again, and this sort of tone, it goes to confirm that, and I think you were using the term, let's utilize AGOA for another 10 years. And I think this is what the business community has done. They have just utilized AGOA for what it was, and not take AGOA as an opportunity to build competitiveness. That's why they keep, you know, this problem keeps coming back. So each time the AGOA renewal was in suspense, you could see the kind of panic that it created. And many investors, well, Mauritius also, Mauritius, in many cases, there was much of the issue was about derogation, yeah? The third country fabrics derogation. Investors were basically closing down shop, leaving the country. So I think that, and this keeps coming back, and that's why I want to just say it now. I feel that we just keep repeating mistakes. We don't learn. And by we, I would say African countries generally. The whole point is to be really boosting your competitiveness so you can, you know, stay competitive and export when preferences arise. Just one point on the point you were making about China. You know, China obviously is a giant. There's no, many countries fear China. But you know, and I would say, and there is a session on China that's coming up, but just on that point, I was back in Mauritius a few years back, and doing a study of really this, you know, China in Africa, and looking at, especially after the NFA, the multi-fiber arrangement. Basically, one question, I was surveying several firms in the textile industry, and one key question that I was asking them was, do you fear China? To put it very, very simple terms. And one enterprise that I visited, the chief executive told me very bluntly, China should be fearing us.
What?
Yes, China should be fearing us. Why? And then when you go down the factory, you understand why. It's because the key has basically computerized the operations to such a point that there is, it basically eliminated human error. That's one. That boosts efficiency. So he was giving me numbers. He has been able to boost efficiency by whatever, 40%. Obviously, the downside of that is you don't create many jobs. Yeah? You don't create many jobs. But the few jobs that you have, you save them. I think this is very important. It's not just about creating jobs, but also about saving jobs. And this is something that we tend to forget often. But on the other side, the positive aspect of it is foreign exchange earnings. Okay? The value addition is much bigger. So I think this is the sort of, we should really be thinking along these lines. How do you really boost your competitiveness so that you can compete, so that you can, your esteemed businessman preferences are more.
Thank you. Thank you, Lina. The AGOA issue and learning process raises another issue. How do you learn if you haven't entered the market in the first place?
Yes.
Let's take a quick 10 minutes break for coffee. So we return at 15:52. Precisely.
Organic credentials.
Thank you.
Thank you. In considering the external markets and opportunities that arise therefrom, we want to consider the opportunities arising from trade with emerging partners. We have listened to Vina in the morning, who showed us figures of how trade is increased with China in particular. But it's not just about China, it's about India, it's about Brazil, it's about Russia, and so forth. There is also one interesting perspective, and I was talking to Deborah about this earlier, is that we talk about trade between China, Africa, or India, Africa, but there's also this dynamic with the steel industry in South Africa, where there's this investment from India, which is suffering at the hands of trade from China. So this is happening in our backyard, but it's between India and China investment. So it's interesting that we look at the dynamics with our emerging partners, and I would invite Memory from SAIIA to open this discussion. Memory.
Thank you. So my think piece was on emerging economies as drivers of regional integration in Africa, and in the interest of time, I'll just get into it and discuss how we can work with emerging economies towards the end objective of regional integration. And before I start, I had a quick chat with the lady that was seated to my right before she left, and she wanted to get a sense of what my presentation was going to be about. And she said something that actually resonated with me when I gave her just a brief of what my proposed, you know, solutions are to, you know, how we can engage with emerging economies towards the end of regional integration. And she said that until we're able to cede sovereignty to the regional integration project, most of what we're discussing, most of the solutions that we propose will actually be just wishy-washy. And that's actually very true. And it actually does speak to my presentation. So it's very much dependent on actually countries ceding sovereignty to the regional integration project. So there's actually no coordinated or institutionalized emerging economy approach to regional integration in Africa. Most of the emerging economy engagement in Africa is really at a bilateral level. It doesn't really consider or speak to regional integration imperatives or objectives, so there's no sense of we are investing in South Africa because we want to add to this particular SACO project that South Africa is partaking in, or the SADC project that maybe Zimbabwe is participating. So there is no sense of, or regional integration doesn't really form a part of the considerations when they engage with Africa. So this is as opposed to, for instance, the EU and EU countries, the US, Japan, where these countries have had long-standing programs, projects, you know, funding mechanisms that speak to the regional integration agenda. They've actively participated towards trying to ensure that African countries reach their regional integration goals. So there's a lack of institutional approach both at individual country level, so speaking to individual emerging economies, and also at group level, and here I speak to the BRICS grouping in particular as one that has been of so much prominence in Africa. There was an attempt, particularly on the part of South Africa in 2013, to actually create an institutionalized BRICS approach to regional integration, to development, to industrialization in Africa, and this was manifest in the summit theme that South Africa chose, and also the fact that they invited African leaders to a retreat with BRICS leaders after the summit. To date, nothing concrete has, well, at least in my view, has come out of that. It's been business as usual as far as emerging economies' engagement in Africa is concerned. So they still proceed with investments or projects at a bilateral level without, that don't really speak to regional integration. Maybe over time we'll see a manifestation of whatever it is that they committed to at the retreat, which was basically a commitment to assisting Africa with its industrialization objectives, regional integration, and also development. But yeah, we're yet to see it. So bottom line, the approach of emerging economies to Africa is really haphazard, it's uncoordinated, it's each country just basically, and by each country, emerging economies just basically looking out for itself and its economic interests. So it's not, there's no sense of, you know, trying to help Africa, which particularly when you speak of the trade engagement and investment, there's no sense of, or there's no strong sense of trying to assist Africa with achieving its regional integration goals. So the question is, what can be done, or what is it that African countries can actually do to ensure that their engagement with emerging economies actually leads to a strengthened and more enhanced regional integration? And in answering this question, we have to bear in mind some of the key challenges that face Africa as far as the regional integration agenda is concerned. And most of these, if not all of them, actually have been covered in previous sessions, but just to recap, and in no particular order whatsoever. So the need for structural transformation of Africa's economies, both to facilitate intra-regional trade, which is very important for regional integration, and also to better integrate African economies into global value chains, the need to improve or work on trade facilitation, non-tariff barriers, which are a real problem as far as intra-regional trade is concerned, infrastructure development, and particularly speaking also to network services infrastructure, so your energy, your transport, your communications, and also just basically increasing the competitiveness of Africa's export projects. And there's also been need, I think, to shift away, particularly on the part of African countries and how they negotiate their own trade agreements, to shift away from a very strong emphasis on tariffs, and move towards, you know, more behind the border issues that really have a stronger impact, I feel, on regional integration than tariffs do. So what is the potential role of emerging economies in regional integration in Africa, and how best can African countries leverage on emerging economies' engagement in Africa towards that end? The answer needs to speak to the imperatives that I just mentioned, and some others that were mentioned earlier on in other sessions that I haven't touched on here. I would propose a three-pronged approach. which of course, like I said earlier, is really dependent on countries being able to cede sovereignty to the regional integration project. So number one, there is a need for Africa to actually draw a strategy for regional integration and associated priorities. This might sound a bit redundant considering that, you know, there are plenty of action plans, of declarations, of strategies, of there's so much research that has been done on regional integration. It's actually almost exhausting when you try to go through everything. And some of the challenges that we identified, some of the solutions that were proposed in projects that were actually undertaken even way before I was born, still resonate today. And that is a problem. And there's also the fact that sometimes we look at issues that contribute to regional integration in silos. So you find that there's a discussion on, say for instance, industrial policy, but that discussion on industrial policy does not relate to the discussion on infrastructure. So the infrastructure that you intend to develop or build doesn't speak to what you actually want to focus on as far as your industrial policy action plan is concerned. And then regional integration is discussed as a concept in itself, and you know, it leaves out all the other extraneous issues that actually contribute to that. So I would propose that there be an integration of the numerous plans and strategies and declarations and the research that has been done, you know, for years on end and shelved. There needs to be some kind of brains trust. And it sounds a bit far-reaching, but it sounds a bit of an overreach. But I think there is actually a need for that, because we have so many doors that are just all over the place, and there isn't any process currently, at least as far as I know, that links all the dots and actually relates the dots to regional integration. So everything speaks to regional integration, but it's just dealt with separately in silos, and it's just haphazard. So maybe there is a need for the various institutions that deal with these issues. So looking at your regional economic communities, looking at your African Union, your NEPAD, your UNECA. So maybe there is a need for those institutions to actually come together, and including, of course, business associations, because there is actually a tendency to leave business out of the discussion, and yet business is really at the core when you talk about trade and regional economic integration. So there is a need to bring together all those institutions and all the other relevant stakeholders, so your business, your labor, your civil society, bring all of them to the table, and out of that group, create a brain trust that actually dedicates itself to creating a strategic living documents, actually, because circumstances change. Somebody mentioned in the morning that, you know, the global political economy has changed over time. So circumstances change, and this strategic plan has to be a living document that can be updated as and when is necessary. So that's number one, creating a strategy for Africa that is focused on regional integration and associated priorities. Number two, crafting a joint strategic, joint African strategic approach and response to emerging economies. So what I mean by that, one could use the strategy for regional integration that I've just mentioned as the basis for that joint strategic approach to how we engage with emerging economies. And this will assist to facilitate an institutionalized approach to emerging economies. And the advantages of that is that it actually, well, in my opinion, it actually counters whatever negative effects that flow from the fact that emerging economies engage at a bilateral level. So meaning that where emerging economies concentrate, say, their investments on resource-rich countries, if there is a joint strategic approach to how we engage with emerging economies, then there is actually a chance that there might be trickle-down benefits for those countries that are not so well endowed with natural resources. So this would allow for the efficient allocation of resources and also eliminate the duplication of projects as well. So even if project investments or projects are limited to one country, if such project has regional spillovers, then it contributes to regional integration. So hence the need for a strategic plan. So when countries negotiate with emerging economies, then they can negotiate with the regional priorities in mind. Of course, this means that there has to be a linkage between the regional priorities and domestic development plans. Because for as long as the two do not speak to each other, then there will always be a conflict between regional priorities and domestic priorities. And usually domestic priorities trying for the regional priorities. So there's a need to have a bottom-up approach. As we craft our strategies, there is a need to have that bottom-up approach so that as countries engage with emerging economies and as countries negotiate whatever investments are coming into their country, they can also actually contribute towards creating regional spillovers that contribute to regional integration. And then thirdly, there also needs to be beyond emerging economies, there is a need to have an inclusive approach to how we engage with partners in general. So meaning that we have our traditional partners that I mentioned earlier on, so your EU, your US, your Japan, and so there are those traditional partners that have always been there in Africa doing their bit towards achieving African regional integration. And then there are the emerging economies now, and obviously their approach is different. For example, when it comes to infrastructure development, for instance, emerging economies tend to focus on hard infrastructure, whereas our traditional partners tend to focus on both hard infrastructure and soft infrastructure. So they tend to go beyond you know, just the buildings, just the, you know, they also look into regulatory issues or behind the border issues as well. So actually integrating the two, approaching however you engage with emerging economies with what the traditional partners are doing in mind actually helps facilitate, you know, enhanced regional integration, because then you can have the two speaking to each other. Even if the traditional partners are not speaking to the emerging economies as far as their engagement in Africa is concerned, Africa can take it upon itself to actually facilitate that meeting of minds. So whatever they negotiate with emerging economies, it should actually be made to speak to what the traditional partners are already doing. Or if the traditional partners have something new that they want to implement, that they want to invest in, then it should also speak to what the emerging economies are already doing or intend to do. And in that way, we can further strengthen and enhance regional integration. And well, there have been talks around having a trilateral approach to development aid in Africa, and I think that same approach could actually be used as far as trade and investment is concerned. So, for instance, we could ensure that aid for trade initiatives by both emerging economies as well as traditional partners actually speak to, you know, the overall strategy that I mentioned earlier as needing to be crafted. So in that way, we don't have you know, different partners doing different things that do not, at the end of the day, converge towards the objective of regional integration. And another example is actually the US AGOA program. It could be made, and Chris mentioned earlier on about how it could be used to facilitate entry into regional value chains. It could also be used to facilitate engagement between, or to facilitate a joint engagement between the US, as far as this AGOA program is concerned, and say, for instance, China, as far as this you know, SCZ project is concerned. China has been busy, you know, building special economic zones in Africa. So surely there is a way in which you could make the two meet. So for whatever products that African countries can export to the US under AGOA, if China is building special economic zones, surely there is a way in which you could negotiate such that those special economic zones actually used to add value to the products that are exported to the US under AGOA. Yeah, and I think maybe there is I haven't really thought this through, but maybe there is a possibility that African countries could also look into the possibility of the harmonization of preferential trade programs and objectives, both by our traditional partners and, of course, now China and India also offering trade preferences to African countries. So maybe if we think through it, there might be, you know, possibilities of harmonizing the two towards, you know, ensuring greater value for African countries and strengthening the regional integration project. So in conclusion, I would say that you know, emerging economies potentially offer new opportunities to Africa in regional integration, but how we leverage on those potential opportunities is really dependent on African countries taking it upon themselves to be the drivers of the end of this engagement between emerging economies and Africa, because I think the norm has been for African countries to actually to be involved in a race to the bottom to ensure that they receive an investment from this country, that they get aid from this country. So maybe if we're a bit more proactive as African countries in how we engage with them, we could actually negotiate towards you know, better regional, greater and stronger regional integration. So, and the strategy, of course, to speak to both emerging and traditional partners, I don't think it's prudent to speak to emerging economies only to the exclusion of traditional partners, because both of them are actually in Africa and engaging in activities that actually have an impact on regional integration. I'll leave it to you.
Thank you, Memory, and you make a very interesting point on this regarding this bilateral approach we have with emerging partners. Those of us that have attended the China-Africa Summit, it's called Africa-China Summit, but in essence, each head of state walks away with a check of his own. You know, there is no presentation of this is our project as Africa, we want you to fund this project as Africa. No. Each one comes back with his own check. Martin, talk to us about China. Are we in a win-win relationship with China?
Could we? Not sure about that. Okay, good afternoon, everybody, and thanks for the kind invitation. Just some thoughts, if I may, and maybe it's slightly off topic, but not too much. Just get me back on topic if I do. Rhetorical question, is China disruptive because of the sheer size of its demand, or is China disruptive by the way it deploys capital abroad in a very geopolitical / geoeconomic fashion? That's what you think about. And I put both of these in two words, both sort of aspects to this. Supply and demand. The supply side is China providing capital to this continent, largely through, we all know, state enterprises, of which there are, I think, 94 now, the Fortune 500. Of those 94, two-thirds are in the continent in some form or other. Of those 60-odd companies, there's two financiers, China Exim Bank, China Development Bank, and ultimately one shareholder, Beijing. So, you know, my definition of how you measure who's winning in Africa, people automatically assume it's China's game over. I don't agree, because for me, return or measuring return is ultimately shareholder value, rather than vague, hard-to-define geopolitical national interests, which people tend to, I think, over-analyze at times. But more on the demand side, and this is more what is really underwritten, I've been saying this for many years, it really underwritten the Africa Rising narrative. The Africa Rising narrative is nothing more than headline quantitative high GDP growth, which I would argue is underpinned by a China-driven, China-propelled commodity supercycle. Now, those of you who are South African in the room, hands up, please, South Africans. Okay, I've got some really bad news for you, don't shoot the messenger. In the last 4 years, those of you earning rands and paying tax rands with varying degrees of willingness, you have lost 81% of your net worth measured in US dollar terms, 81%. The rand has always tracked commodity prices, always has, pretty much. So, those of you earning rands should be pretty obsessed with growth figures coming out of China, and particularly China's growth to fixed capital formation spend as a percentage of GDP in recent years, which still stands at 47% of GDP. South Africa, I've heard figures between 17 and 22, which is almost on a par with Brazil. We are right now the anti-China growth model, i.e. not investment driven. So what does this mean for the continent? I want to just bring this very topical right up to date right now, and we know the bearish sentiment, the very negative sentiment around emerging markets, of which clearly South Africa is part. We're a flat line, at best, momentum economy, chugging along, largely self-inflicted as well, arguably, at a 1.5%, using a sort of, people would say, self-inflicted wound, as Goldman Sachs says, or if you're set flat, you'd say scoring own goals. But either of the two is accurate. But I got some figures here which, from an article, I think it was the Economist magazine about a year ago, and I adapted it slightly to put things in context. And another rhetorical question, is the world, the global economy, converging or diverging from an emerging market perspective? Put differently, do you think that we in the emerging world, developing world, are catching up with the developed? All of us are pretty optimistic, and we kind of think that if we get the recipe right, we work hard, we diversify, you've heard those words, we'll succeed, and we'll become like West Europeans or Americans, i.e. wealthy. That's the convergence story. My argument is quite different. I think the world is diverging. And the convergence story has been nothing more than a China story and a commodity story the last decade and a half. Some figures around this. Between 2000 and 2009, and I'll come back to the Africa trading part now, which I think is really quite profound, profoundly important. In the decade 2000-2009, we call this the great catch-up period. Output per person in the emerging market world doubled over the course of that roughly decade. Our growth rate of that output was 7.6% per annum, emerging world, 4.5 developed countries. Take the US as a measure of that. This convergence, the speed differential, would result in, on a per capita basis, nominal, emerging market citizens, that's us mostly, catching up in 30 years, three decades. That's kind of Asia style. Think Singapore, think South Korea, think largely eastern, southern provinces of China the last 20, 30 years. That's good news. If we're looking at data from 2008 to 2014 now, the last sort of 6 years, the growth differential, the GDP per head increase, was significantly less, at 2.6% differential rather than 4.5. EM is a basket. If we take China out, the speed differential is only 1.1 for emerging world. Catch up then taking 115 years. Okay, looking quite bleak, but it gets worse. Using IMF projections right now for 2015, emerging market forecast, ex-China, we take China out of the emerging market basket. Speed differential, figures I've got here, 0.39%. Catch-up period, emerging world, developing to developed, 300 years. Why? As I repeat, the convergence story was a China story and a commodity story. The China demand, disruptive by its sheer scale and inflationary impact on commodities, particularly solid commodities. The oil price story of the last sort of post mid-2009 oil price recovery has not been a market-driven, market-price-determined story. It's been a speculative story. Too much cash in the system, clearly pushing up oil to triple digits and beyond. Even Goldman Sachs was talking $200 oil. That was totally wrong. So for me, is this Africa rising narrative, having been underpinned by the artificial economics of state capitalism in China, talk about the steel sector now, irrelevant to us. And arguably the headwinds, the economists would call it, are quite significant for the emerging world. In particular, those countries which really have failed to take full advantage of the most enabling decade, arguably, these countries ever had. I think Africa, by and large, with a few exceptions. So what's the future of this? Memory mentioned sort of industrialization and value chains. One of the key reasons why, and Nigel talked about this last week, one of the key reasons why African countries don't trade with each other is not because of policy or lack of infrastructure or, you know, communication barriers, whatever it may be, it's simply there's no value chains. What I see in South Africa is that, you know, unlike Asia, Japan comes too expensive, production moves into China, Korea, Southeast Asia, same with Taiwan, it moves into China. Korea becomes too expensive, it moves into China. China becomes too expensive, it moves into Vietnam. And the whole regional value chains, supply chains, drive intra-regional trade. That's real integration. It's not through policies of governments. It's through a consequence of the market, effectively. There's no silver bullet policy towards integration, I would argue, despite the fact we always seem to seek one. In our case, South African corporates, and this is the industrial engine room, despite the best efforts of ESCOM to change that. ESCOM employees, you know who you are. We remain industrial engine room. South African corporates go to business, manufacturing sectors, think textile garments, think steel, think whatever it may be. Does industry relocate to Mozambique or Namibia or to Tanzania or to Botswana to take advantage of lower production costs? No, it just disappears and starts sourcing from Asia. Simple. So what I'm seeing is a migratory impact of business. Had business moved to Mozambique or to Namibia or Angola or whatever neighboring countries, I guarantee we'd have significant greater intra-regional integration measured by trade because of that corporate value chain that had been created. I think that's fairly obvious. So what's going on now, I think, and a couple of last points, is we're on the cusp, arguably, of a 19th century style Northwest England industrial revolution in Africa. But I can't say Africa because that's wrong. I'm very bearish on West Africa, sorry if you're Nigerian. I'm very positive on East Africa, I think Ethiopia, to an extent Kenya. The manufacturing story will be a East Coast issue, Southern potentially. It will not be a West Coast story or a hinterland story of a continent. We can't talk about this great generics of African East to benefit. It doesn't. Certain countries will. And we've seen Ethiopia, when I was first in China 25 years ago, you see, and I go to Addis now occasionally, you see similar sort of chaos, dust everywhere, construction going up, everyone running around being busy. Not quite sure how this is going to play out, but the city's being created. Not quite a Shenzhen, perhaps, but something second or third tier China style. And that's happening. Why is industrialization almost inevitable? Well, according to Justin Lin, you know this, from Beijing University, former chief economist of World Bank, China will lose in the next decade 80 to 85 million jobs. Not because the government decided so, because market forces. Lewis Turley Point, cost of production, outstrip gains in productivity. Lewis Turley Point is not a specific point in time, as it is a general sort of pendulum swing shift that's taking place. So where are these guys going? Where are these jobs going? Largely Vietnam, Indonesia, Myanmar, Thailand, to an extent South Asia, and those countries. Where's the African Vietnam? It's going to be Ethiopia. It's already happening. Now, the South Africans will say, and I heard this morning in Victoria, we want decent work. We don't want sweatshops. But guys, come on. We have an unemployment rate real. I'm told, Zoli Zimabali says 36%. It's unacceptable. Politically, economically, morally. So, clearly, as we start to hopefully industrialize at the low end, as China 25 years ago, start to move outside, 2001 WTO, etc., is we can start to move up that value chain, start to increase regional trade, providing regional economies, think EAC, particularly get it and start to drive us forward. Last point, what to do now? Textile garments is history in this country. We kind of know that. We talk about it as if we used to have it, and it's kind of true. Steel sector. I think there's 50 odd countries that manufacture steel. Those of you who follow the news with ArcelorMittal, with Evraz, Score, and these guys, I mean, it's at the point of extinction. Problem being, and this is a bit of a dig at state capitalism, we've had false economics in China for a number of years, for decades in fact. One of the last sectors to truly reform has been the steel sector because it's strategically important, whatever that means. In response to the Western financial shock, September 2008, PRC government put $600 billion, roughly, through China Development Bank and a couple of others, into infrastructure spend in the country. That gave a final lifeline, one big last shot to the steel sector, to roll out, as you see it, the airports. 140 odd airports are now being built in China simultaneously. 140 odd airports. Heathrow is arguing for a new runway. China with 140 new airports. Are they the market demand? Probably not. Doesn't matter. Makes for good headline growth figures. high-speed trains, more urbanization, etc., etc. That was a final shot in the arm for the steel sector. Now you have a situation of significant overcapacity in the steel sector. There are roughly 800 companies, roughly, with 20% of those companies accounting for about 80-90% of production. So 80% of those companies actually are markets of purpose and will disappear. So it's not about profit, it's about cash flow. They will export as much as they can, while they can, to continue their survival. Who's on receiving end of this? The developing world. It's not fair, it's called state economics. The market did not allocate capital effectively in China or efficiently in China. The state intervened, and this is a result. And now we have to bear the brunt of that, arguably. To conclude, is, and that applies to many sectors, but overcapacity in China is arguably the primary driver of competitiveness. To conclude, I think that this convergence versus divergence story, it's not very, not a happy story, but during this convergence period, many observers, banks, governments, got ahead of themselves and created these really sexy acronyms. Think CIBITS, MINTS, and BRICS, because they truly believed, Goldman Sachs for more selfish reasons, politicians for more, I don't know, geopolitical reasons, believed that the world was actually changing, that the emerging world truly was catching up, where in fact the convergence story was a China story and a commodity story. Now countries, including ourselves, especially those that are commodity driven, I think African countries especially, have to work to grow. Because prior to 2013, and that was a specific time, mid-2013, when all the Chinese money had been spent, it was relatively easy, because a rising tide of commodity demand and liquidity from QE out of the US lifted all boats. Now we have a multi-speed world, where countries are trying to find what is their speed of growth, what is their correct speed of growth. Some will embrace free trade, some will do the opposite in response to this. The policy discussion for me is how do states react to, how do governments react to strong economic headwinds, very tough domestic conditions, intense competition on the production side coming out of China, and very, very low commodity prices with deteriorating terms of trade. Do they become more liberalized or do they become more protections? I think for me that's a real issue that many countries, including South Africa, now face. Thank you.
Wow. that's the question. I have three discussants on this matter. Obviously, due to the importance of the subject and the currency of the subject and so forth. So I'll start with Catherine. I'll give you 3 minutes, and then Geoffrey and Nigel, 3 minutes each. Catherine.
Okay, thank you very much. And thanks to Memory and Martin for their presentations. For me, they've raised more questions than I have actual comments, so 3 minutes is probably not bad. What I want to pick up on mainly is a theme that ran through, I think, both presentations, which Martin spoke to at the very end, and this is the role of the state in a lot of these issues. I think that it's incredibly important. Memory even referred to it at the very beginning in terms of sovereignty hindering regional integration in the African context as well. And I think that for me, one of the key things is that if we're going to develop responses to shifts that are taking place that Martin has eloquently described in this new multi-speed world, we've got to see greater levels of interaction between the state and other players. And for me, that would be my clear message, if you like, is why are we not talking to the private sector more in African governments in particular? Why are we not understanding some of these decision-making processes that are taking place, for example, the idea of the migration of business amongst regional players? And also, I think we've always assumed to a certain degree that historical linkages between the private sector, for example, in Africa and Europe, are fairly fixed, if you like. But that's not the case when you're dealing with relationships with emerging players in particular. And I think it's even a greater reason to emphasize the need for greater levels of public-private interaction and dialogue as we go forward. It's also interesting for me that we're seeing that liberal shift play out in terms of trade policy in the Asia Pacific in particular through the negotiations of the mega regional agreements. And that raises questions for me in terms of what are the implications for African countries of the linkages being created between Latin America, Asia, the US through the TPP, but also what will happen when we see the RCEP come online, with China playing in a much greater role in that space, also accompanied by its Silk Road Initiative going into South Asia as well. But what does that actually mean for us? Are we going to be further excluded from these value chains? Are we just going to see a greater level of perpetuation of linkages taking place within existing systems in Asia? And you know, how will that impact on the China story? Martin perhaps can answer some of those questions. And really, we've seen trade agreements not living up to what they offer in the African context. And there has been some attempts to talk to emerging economies, if you like, about greater levels of trade linkages. We've seen the SAIIA preferential trade agreement dragging on for years now. Not that it was ever going to offer anything much anyway, but even in terms of an actual negotiating process, we haven't been able to get a very basic agreement that would have probably covered maybe 10-15% of trade between the two groups concluded. So you know, do we stand a chance in terms of looking at greater levels of rules of the game, if you like, through trade agreements with these emerging economies? I would want to expand on South Africa as an emerging economy and what that means for the rest of the continent, because currently South Africa is the one country that puts its hand up and participates in these many acronym-like groups such as BRICS, for example, but is also a member of the G20. And is there as an emerging economy. What does that actually mean in terms of South Africa's approaches, including to regional integration and to its role within the broader African grouping? I really think we're overstating the Ethiopia story. I'll take that on with Martin at another time. Thanks.
Thank you. Geoffrey?
This subject is so interesting that we could spend all week. But I will take on the presentations in the order that I made. I think that I'll comment on Memory's presentation. I think they like her thinking, particularly the emphasis on the inability of African governments to focus on the regional integration issue to the extent that it's not yielding much progress, refers to silos, and I see that quite a lot with my engagement with SADC, for instance, because there are summits every time in SADC. There will be a trade summit, there will be an energy summit, there's an infrastructure summit, there's more prominently security and defense summit. Now, those summits don't seem to talk to each other, and therefore not feeding into the regional integration platform, so to speak. So you find that a whole lot of time is being spent on agreeing and signing agreements. But these countries, individual countries, are carrying on as if this regional integration discussion is not going on. They are still engaging their developmental partners in Europe, in America, and signing off completely new agreements as if regional integration is not on the table elsewhere in the room. And I tend to agree with what Mark, he made a parallel of what EU did and what we are doing in Africa. EU was building on already existing capacities in order to integrate, but we are integrating before the capacity has been created. And you wonder where that is going to take us. And because there's nobody coordinating all these activities in energy, in infrastructure, and defense, and all these things, it's very difficult to see what lies ahead. Governments do not produce goods and services. All right? But governments continue sitting to discuss regional integration. The question is regional integration for what? Isn't it for business to grow? Isn't it for trade to grow? So how come the manufacturers of goods and services are not at the table during the discussions, during the most intense, lengthy discussions that are going on? I would like to beg that in the absence of participation, full participation by private sector, and I mean representative private sector, because what happens in cases, certain governments will just identify people they know in the private sector and get them to the table. And those guys are not representing any sector, they're just representing personal interests, perhaps. But what comes out is not a representative argument for business. So those silos will remain, the protocols will be signed, but without an enforcement mechanism, without a court of justice where a defaulting Zimbabwe will be made to come to boot. If Zambia defaults, what happens? The party carries on. So when will regional integration happen if everybody is doing their own thing? I would like to argue that regional integration has to start with facilitation. And therefore, it's my view that infrastructure development on a regional basis, that is rail, airports, customs border points, the integrated border management systems, the issues which our lady from Lesotho referred to, easing trade and cross-border traders so that the system is effective and efficient. People can come from Mozambique, from the port in one day and be able to reach Congo the very next day without having to pass through 72 roadblocks by police who demand money. And we are paid. It's even leading to sexual molestation when those women are unable to pay. Now, for me, those are the issues that governments must deal with in order to facilitate business, to incentivize business to integrate. Because the gentleman that wants to expand into the Congo from Kenya will take 3 years doing a due diligence because of uncertainty in terms of government services, government procedures, government. Those are the issues that private sector needs to see action on from the governments when they meet to ensure that business is facilitated and incentivized to cross the borders so that they can serve the bigger and wider markets instead of summits that just end up in protocols which nobody respects. On the China issue, Chairman, rather than vilify China, I would like to argue that China has brought a dimension which is just causing so much discomfort in the West that it's being portrayed as a bad partner in trade and business. One needs to look at what was happening to Africa before China emerged as an economic power, literally nothing. So now China is in the game and doing extremely big business and threatening the very, very valuable position of the Western economies and Western business. Everybody wants to make China look like a bad partner in international trade. I would rather that people react, businesses react, economies react to the threat that China has posed in a meaningful and respectful, mutual respect going across to everyone, because there is value being added. The IMF World Bank model has largely failed Africa. Can one show me a model based on World Bank IMF models that has succeeded to alleviate poverty in Africa? So for us in the business sector, I think that any solution that delivers a win-win solution must be embraced, because it will deliver on the spectrum of the society that has hitherto been unsupported. So for me, Chair, I think that business, like you deal with any competitor, China must be looked at as a competitor adding value to the world economy. Thank you.
Thank you. Of course, in assessing your point of view, Geoffrey, in a win-win situation, as you put it, there's a question of infrastructure development, because China has been very strong in Africa in that respect. The question is, that has that created enough employment for the Africans? Has that created spin-offs for the economy? Because that money that is being invested should be able to create spin-offs other sectors of the economy. That's the question. Nigel, where are you?
I'm going to try and talk without the speakers. I'll be very, very brief.
For the webcasting,
they're recording.
Thank you.
Okay. I think very excellent presentations and points raised by Catherine and Geoffrey. And I think from my side, I've only been in my position for the last 2 months, looking at African industrial policy for the Department of Trade and Industry. And I think what really strikes me is that there are excellent strategies that have been developed over many years, but they remain as high-level strategies. And everyone's talking about value chains, everyone's talking about deepening integration, but I don't see how that comes together yet from a very much a project perspective, from narrowing down around what projects. Yes, they're talking about mining, agri, pharmaceutical seems to have come through as one of the three priorities. I'm not sure where the jobs are there. So, but there doesn't seem to be a lot further coming out from there. And I think in relation to emerging economies, and I think the lesson coming through from perhaps from China's approach is that they have focused down on very specific, perhaps self-interested projects, but they've made things happen. And I think maybe going forward, yes, it's going to be a really, really tough ride for the next 5 to 10 years from a commodity perspective, but what do we do to overcome that? And I think perhaps a lesson, looking particularly at China, I think Brazil in certain instances, India and others, is really getting down to the nub of commercial projects or projects that are going to run work. And I think certainly our focus, or part of our focus from the Department of Trade and Industry, is really going to be trying to identify what these real projects are, doing research, specific research around it, informed by the private sector, trying to put commercial players together, and really on the back behind that, then trying to use that as perhaps one of the putting the horse before the cart in terms of some of the trade negotiations that perhaps go on behind that. So I think certainly just from my side, very interesting points. Very, very lots of questions that clearly have been raised, and I don't think there's any easy path. I think really the key is going to be around a systemic approach going forward, but based really on concrete proposals. Maybe just the very last point, I think there has been a lot of very good work that's been done around the special development initiatives, around corridors, but from what I can see, a lot of that has fallen, has gone very quiet. And I know in certain instances there is still work happening, but I don't think those are also very useful instruments around which region, at a sub or at a regional level, we can come together around resolving some of the issues that Geoffrey and others have spoken about. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for those comments from discussants. We you know, this discussion about emerging partners always tends to narrow down to China. But we are in SADC. We're in SADC, and we have an emerging partner here, South Africa. What is the role South Africa is playing in order to bring along other countries in the SADC region. If South Africa indeed is dominant in the exports into Europe, dominant in the exports in the US, surely through the value chain system, they should be able to carry on products from neighboring countries in order to enhance trade in the region. This is something that we need to talk about, the positive side of the dominance of South Africa in the region. The floor is open for questions, answers, and contributions. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. The presentations have been excellent and very enlightening in a lot of areas. I just want to maybe pursue one of the strategies that Member presented in terms of the four strategies that you talked about. There's one that I'm curious about. The one where you said there should be a joint, or we should link domestic development plans with regional integration strategies or agenda. Somehow I ask myself the question, the countries in the region are not at the same levels of development. How then do we link that? How do we do it to get to a point where we can say we are moving together? And what you've just said, Your Excellency, to say they, South Africa, moving ahead and partnering with China and them, one of those things could be take along what the other member countries are producing and trading on. Somehow we seem to be all focused on our own individual areas. Maybe it's the same thing as sovereignty issues for me. So I don't know if the message is not sinking to those that get to sign the agreements, because that debate has been going on forever. You know. So maybe you can try and unpack that a little bit for me.
Thank you, Osir. I have Honorable Mutati and then Charles.
Thank you, moderator. In 2010, I was part of the delegation from Zambia, then as Minister of Trade, who went into China. And one of the ambitions that we had at that particular time is how can we deal with the issue of creating jobs? How can we deal with the issues of poverty reduction? And how can we accelerate development in the country? Our engagement with China resulted in Zambia being selected as an experiment for what was called economic zone. We agreed with China that they're going to invest approximately $2 billion in this particular economic zone. From the perspective of the politician, those sounds were critically important at the national level. So China came in and began to invest in the economic zone. That was 2010. As politicians then in government, we thought we were gaining the momentum, and this was a good platform for the elections that were only 1 year ahead, 2011. But what the people did appreciate was that that strategy was seen to favor China much more than Zambia. They felt that the jobs that were going to be created were being compromised because the Chinese came with their own labor, and lots of them. In consequence, we lost the 2011 election. Despite the fact that we brought investment. So it's the way you connect with the population in terms of them seeing the outputs of investment and how it will benefit the nation, not short term but long term. And compromising the political drama to economic reality. That should be more or less the direction that us politicians should begin to take. But I think we tend to like the sound bites much more than analysis. So yes, China will continue to be a factor in Africa. I know there are no politicians in here. The Zambia case is very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Charles, then Jody.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, your last intervention was, what can South Africa do so that we can trade amongst ourselves? South Africa being a dominant country within SADC. I believe it's very simple. Try to understand each other, try to understand the other countries, try to understand the special needs, specificities, and requests of other countries. And the South African negotiators, they are stubborn. They don't want to move positions, whether it comes from their politicians, and they don't want to understand the specificities of the island states specifically. Thank you. Jody, you have the floor, and then Rob.
Thank you very much, excellent presentations. Just have a quick question for memory. And you spoke about the need for a more institutionalized approach towards dealing with the emerging powers, China-Africa relations and so on. So I was wondering what exactly you had in mind and what would that institutional approach entail, if you could just elaborate a little bit further on that. And then Martin just had a question for you. I think the message about the kind of commodity boom, the China story, that came out really strong. You're rather pessimistic, I feel. And I was wondering if you'd given any thought to the kind of next wave of Chinese investment and Chinese multinational companies, which have kind of different motivations compared to the previous wave. And then in terms of Ethiopia and, I agree that its growth performance has been quite impressive, and it's also taken quite a different approach towards stimulating its growth process. What exactly can South Africa or other African countries learn? I mean, given that the model deployed in Ethiopia, I mean, it's been quite it's been a developmental state approach. It's been very targeted. Within key sectors, and this stimulating kind of learning processes has been really, really for domestic firms has been really, really central there. So I was thinking, it's great, but what can other African countries learn, and what can they really do in practice?
I have Ralph and then Fina.
Thank you for the opportunity. I must admit that I am a new member to the Seychelles Chambers of Commerce and Industry, but I've been a long-time observer of the local business community in Seychelles and the African business community, even the European business community. The different intervention today has been fantastic, frightening, scaremongering, and I could go on and on and on and on. But at the end of the day, the reality is about doing business to prosper our people. And this is what we need to find together. Seychelles being small, sometimes what is the continent reality is totally different from our reality. Seychelles as a country depends on tourism, main economic activities, fisheries, and the financial sector. But it was okay when people from Seychelles, Africa, if we look at the bigger picture, were depositing money in Swiss bank account, and New York, and in France, in Paris, or whatever. With the emerging of the offshore, now Seychelles, Mauritius, and other countries in the region has been involved in that sector for a while. Now it is not okay for Americans to come and deposit money in our financial sector. So these are the little things that points out the hypocrisy of the Western world. And we've been at their mercy for a long time. And this is the more reason why, as African countries, we need to look within the continent, within Africa, to find opportunities and how to evolve and do business amongst ourselves. As my good friend rightly put, what was happening in Africa before China stepped in? Practically nothing. So China saw an opportunity, not for Africans, but for the Chinese. That is the reality. And as a former politician, I tend to speak a lot, but I will thank you and stop here. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you, Rob. Vina and then Mike Morris.
Thank you. The question about why the Western world is anxious about China's invasion of Africa is because, and I think this is something that we haven't talked about here, is because China is not playing by the rules. China, as you know, is not a member of the Paris Club. And therefore, it doesn't have to abide by the rules set by the club when it comes to providing aid. You have the whole issue about effectiveness, transparency, and all that. In China, it's so much easier. They just go into a country, they provide financing, they bring their own people, they do the project. So this is when you don't play by the rules, when you don't have a level playing field, obviously there is no way the Western world can compete with China. Now, while we have that, in Africa, I think, and my memory made this point very very well, and it's something that I've also talked about earlier in my own research on China in Africa, which is that, and I think it goes back to this, to the heart of what we're discussing. We are talking about regional integration. We are talking about regional cooperation. Yeah? Is it regional cooperation really, or is it regional competition? I feel that it's more of the latter. Because when it comes to dealing with emerging partners, it's a race to the bottom. That's what it is. Every country is trying to get the biggest chunk. Nobody is speaking to each other. There is no regional platform to deal with China, while China has the FOCAC, the forum. Okay? There is no equivalent from the African side. Why aren't we thinking about that? Because at the end of the day, what will happen is, Martin talked about this whole divergence on the earlier story. But even within Africa, you will see a sort of two-speed or multiple-speed sort of transformation. Some countries, you know, again, this race to the bottom will take them to deal with countries. You will have China coming in, investing, and obviously, in the long term, you don't know what the benefits really are going to be. Okay, you basically you are in a way giving to China your natural resources, and many countries increasingly are doing that. I was just reading yesterday in New York Times, was it, about China going into Ecuador and implementing the Angola model. I mean, it's the Angola model all over. So we don't think about this. I think we tend to say that, okay, yeah, they are coming, they are bringing money, they are building infrastructure. We are paying China with oil, we are paying China with natural resources. What does that imply for the future? We are not thinking about that. Now, one thing also, and this is a different point I wanted to make, this discussion has been so far basically been monopolized by China. Okay? China is not the only emerging economy out there. We have India also. Nobody is talking about India, right? And I want to know why. Maybe, of course, you have this big elephant in the room which is dwarfing everyone else. But I mean, why not India? I mean, if you look at it, India has this trade preference scheme. China also has a trade preference scheme. And by the way, we are not talking about those. We are not talking about benefits, potential benefits that China can bring to the continent that can in some ways offset some of the other negative aspects associated with China's involvement in the continent. So, trade. China has this scheme for LDCs that they launched back in, I think, 2010. Yeah? Is Africa benefiting from that scheme? If not, why not? Has any country really exported to China under the trade preference scheme? What sort of experiences are coming out? Nobody is talking about this. Same applies to India. And it's not just a matter of trade, of investment and aid, but also technological collaboration, technology transfer. What is the story there? Is there any, again, might be a probability question, from China's involvement in Africa, do we see a sort of technology transfer? I would be suspicious. I mean, probably I know the answer already. But for India, okay, for India, this story has been more positive, at least from what I have read. Okay? But India has brought to some countries technology that has ultimately helped countries build capacity to produce something, capacity ultimately to trade also. Okay? So I feel that these issues are not being discussed. And at the end of the day, I feel that therefore we are having a discussion that is in a way skewed. So I don't know if we have time to bring this up, but let's also keep those in mind.
Thank you. Mike and then Deborah.
I wasn't going to say anything, but I decided that maybe I should. Martin, I don't agree with a lot of what you said. Convergence, divergence. Actually, it's much too simple. It's not a simple case of convergence and divergence between the developed world and the developing world. If you look at the global picture, there's divergence that is taking place within the northern countries, both between countries and within countries. You have massive rising inequality that is occurring in, for example, Europe and the United States. There's a decrease in disposable income of not only of the working class but of the actual lower middle class that is taking place in these countries. Why they vote in England for Cameron is beyond me, because actually the net result of this is that large sections of the middle class are actually losing in the long term out of this process. Greece is an example of divergence between countries. So that's the first one. In terms of the countries, in terms of the developing world, you have both divergence and convergence. It depends whether you look at the rise of middle classes and within Africa and in the developing world, or whether you ignore them and treat them as a global box and you look at simply per capita incomes. Basically what is occurring in Africa is the rise of the middle class, and it's an inexorable rise of the middle class at the very same time as you can have increasing inequality and you, within Africa at the very same time. So the divergence-convergence story has to be understood on the basis of looking both within countries and between countries, and both within the developing world and within the developed world as well. That's the first thing. Second of all, China's not the only emerging, the only player on the block that has resulted in this major shift in globalization. The rise of emerging economies are really important. They don't have the same scale impact as China, but there's a major process of urbanization that is taking place in a large number of emerging economies. And urbanization results in greater infrastructure development, which results in greater demand for commodities at the same time. So Joby's quite right to say that you're painting a much too gloomier picture. If you look at the data and the stuff on the commodity prices, what you have is a leveling out of commodity prices after the major jump that has occurred, the startling impact that has occurred from 2000 and particularly up to 2007. Then you have to differentiate between different kinds of commodities. In terms of soft commodities, there's not a drop, and there's no impact. There's no, the data doesn't show that there's going to be a major drop in prices of soft commodities. On the contrary, if you look at, for example, at cocoa, there's a major shortage of cocoa in the world, and there will be likely to be an increase in the price of commodities. It's what you do with it that counts. If you look at energy, yes, there is a major drop in the prices of oil, and that is perfectly true. If you look at hard commodities, mineral commodities, there's a differentiation that's taking place. What's critical here is the price, both of, is the cost of production and not just the demand. So on the demand side, I say to you that there is the demand will carry on. On the production, on the supply side, there's an increase, significant increase in the cost of producing copper. For example, if you're looking, if you're taking it from the Zambian perspective, both in terms of exploration and in terms of production, this will impact upon the prices of commodities. If you look at the manufacturing side of the terms of trade, you have to differentiate between knowledge-intensive production products and production-intensive products. In terms of knowledge-intensive products, there's been a massive increase in the price of these kinds of products. But in terms of labor-intensive type of products, there's a continual decrease in production. The net effect of this is that the terms of trade, we are not returning to a previous single world where the terms of trade are in favor of manufacturers and opposed to commodities, in terms of this. On the China story, the real problem here is it's really hard not to blame China or to love China. We have to get out of that stuff. China is neither the saint nor the sinner, in this process. And the Chinese, you know yourself, Martin, the Chinese are perfectly well doing what they want to do, which is basically look after their own interests. However, if they don't do what you want them to do, well then, as an African country, blame your own governments, in the process, and stop moaning at China. They're just doing what they should be doing. If you renegotiate the terms, then there's enough evidence to say that actually the terms will be shifted. If you give them the opportunity, they'll bring in lots of Chinese folks. If you say, no, I'm not prepared to do that, and you've got to use local labor, then the terms, alter. If you allow China to just import raw materials, then they will downgrade your products. Gabon is an example of this in terms of timber. They used to have, if timber sold from Gabon to France was upgraded significantly in terms of plywood and veneers. There's a major study that shows us. When you start selling to China, they say, just give us the rods, we'll do the shit ourselves. Now if you, as the governing government, allow that to happen because your elites are expropriating the rents and sticking them in Swiss banks or wherever they put them these days, that's our problem, That's an African country problem. The same goes, by the way, with Indonesia and Thailand in terms of cassava. When the market shifts to China, give them a chance, they say, we'll upgrade this stuff, ourselves. It's a developing country policy problem. So, what's the consequence of all of this? The one I told you is you can negotiate better. The second part of it is, we have to shift our heads away in terms of commodities towards the question of production linkages. I'm going to talk about this again tomorrow. The critical question is, if to take advantage of resources and raw materials and commodities and the demand from China and the emerging economies, if you just ship out your commodities raw, well, then the rent will be appropriated both by government and particular elites and those who own the mines, etc. If you move towards
production linkages, backward linkages, forward linkages, etc. Then you're on the industrialization path. It's not an industrial policy issue. It's a productive sector policy issue. We have to move away from industrial policy and see this as productive sectors, productive policy, because what we're interested in is building linkages because of we're trying to build industrialization. It's not China's fault. It's our own bloody fault that this occurs.
Yeah.
Okay. A little difficult to follow that. Maybe we'll just switch gears a little bit. First, I just wanted to attack Martin as well, but ever so gently by comparison. Good, I know you can. It's again, you know, I sort of agree with Mike that it's a little bit simplistic to look at convergence and divergence in that way. There is a story of inequality, and there is a story of inequality between countries and among countries, and we have to take regard for how we think about sustainable and inclusive growth. It has to be a target as well. And so while I take your point about allowing and facilitating the market to migrate businesses as an effective response, at the same time you can't just allow proliferation of sweatshops. We have to think about decent work, and we have to find a solution that allows for inclusive and sustainable growth and not just the easy option in that. And then also to respond to Vinay's questions, why don't we talk about India? Well, you might as well also ask, why don't we talk about Malaysia? Because I see, for example, here that Malaysia is the third biggest investor in Africa. And I don't know if it still is this year, but that certainly was until the year before last. Well, maybe because there are relationships there that have worked more productively. I see from the little bit of research I've been doing that Indian investment has led to greater trickle-down effects. It has substantially been established firms rather than new firms. In other words, we're not getting so much of a displacement effect, and you're sort of building on from strength to strength. Or maybe these aren't sort of divisive issues. Maybe there are just lessons there that can be understood and learned and translated into more effective discussion with the other investors, as Mike is asking for.
Thank you. I'll have... I'll have Marcia as the last contributors, then I'll pass on to the speakers.
Okay, thank you, Chair. In fact, I'll speak because I want to raise my flag. Much of the things I want to say, Mike, I've taken from over my mind. I want to say about the Chinese issue, in fact. It depends how the government reacts. I think most of the time we forget because they do good things and they look like the rest and they don't look what they're doing. I remember the case of the border of Putin in Mozambique. There's a legislative passage that the wood cannot be exported without a MIMA process. But they find a way to take the wood out of the camp. So it depends, in fact, how the government look in the issue. So if there's someone to be blamed, it blame our own government. So I think we have to find a way that China, if still don't think cost of the commodity, can contribute to the country in terms of processing part of the tools or other raw material they can. That will be the starting of the creation of value chain in the country. They can be extended to another continent, for example, in the SADC region. Another thing that I would like to point number two is the regional competition versus regional integration. For some time, if you look at the SADC process, it's simple to me that it's a competition among countries, not a process of cooperation among countries. The point that you raised by Davis, he said that what there are certain companies that are failing to advance in data production in South Africa, and then just for the company, why don't this company shift the industry to other starting members? Other thing is that what if the company cannot satisfy a certain order, why you shift part of that order to another country that will be a process of transferring the technology that you use in South Africa, transfer its capacity to other members of SAIIA to also have that capacity to produce and meet the separate requirement in terms of our standard. I think that will be the main role of the emerging economies to transfer this capacity to other companies like Mozambique or Namibia. Thank you, Chair. And I'm sorry about my English, it's not Portuguese.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, sir. What about this China question? I think some of us don't have a problem with competition by any kind. It could be China or India or South Africa. But what some of us have an issue with is the fact that with China, you have a state-owned company that can compete with private companies. In the case of Botswana, you have a company coming from China, a construction company, fully backed by the state, made to compete with a company that has to borrow from the private capital markets. That's what concerns some of us. You can't just sit back and say, we are grumpy and complain about China. That is just not all for some of us. I think that's, for competition, yes, we can compete, that's fine. And then the second point is about this notion of decent work. I think that's Martin also alluded to that. If you look at unemployment levels in Africa, I think we are grappling with a very serious issue. And for you to be, to have the luxury of trying to pick and choose the type of jobs that you can have and taking some of them decent, and I don't know what the other ones are. Possible decent, and I don't even know what defines the decency of a job. Is it the wage or the nature of the job? I don't have a problem in that. I think we're not living in the real world. I should know about decent jobs. I'm sorry.
Thank you. This is again is about. Coherence and you know how these discussions between departments and government, because the question you're asking, I'm sure your labor people are aware of that answer. You know, they have negotiated the decent work program under the ILO, and it's been a robust program for a number of years. Let me just ask Martin to give concluding remarks, and then I will end with memory. Martin.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. I'll try and be brief. Is, you know, Mike is right in saying, as you said earlier, it's the China discussions are always very divisive, and it's one which, you know, the more we talk about China, the more we start to talk about ourselves, perhaps. And I often lay the blame at the foot of African governments. There's certain, you know, Francis Fukuyama talks about a capable state. I talk about Ethiopia. For me, it's not about a political system. It's about the character and caliber of leadership and getting things done, ultimately. I was with a guy this morning. He just came back to South Africa. He's South African, been away for 10 years. He came to South Africa. He says, I can't believe how much the country's changed. I said, what do you mean? He said, whenever I deal with government, I just can't get things done. Visas, you know, all sorts of things. Just can't get things done. And for me, the current comparative advantage is a capable state, i.e., can the government get things done? Okay. And you're looking at this, often this discussion, Ethiopia's case, Rwanda's case, takes place through a lens of rights and human rights, etc. But for me, it's more of a pragmatic, capable state discussion. I think there's a distinct difference there. One of the lessons from Ethiopia, perhaps, is Ethiopia trying to do a Southeast Chinese province model from 20 odd years ago? Well, perhaps it is. The difference between South Africa and Ethiopia, obviously, this is countless, but, you know, a bit like many Southeast Asian countries, Singapore being the stereotypical one, when you're starting from zero, what do you compete with? What do you compete with? I mean, the decimation of private industry in Ethiopia in recent decades is such that you actually have a zero starting point, just like Rwanda. So guys like Kagame and formerly Zanawi and these characters, they're just starting with nothing. So what do? You start something, you start a state, and you've got to kickstart something. Just like the China. China started a lot of industry, but they didn't know, understand the words productive and efficient and, you know, profit, etc. So at a certain point, and I'm very, you know, Jody, don't get me wrong, I'm not an advocate at all of state capitalism. I'm the sort of biggest opponent to it, especially in this country, for reasons I'll outline shortly, related to a question. But to kickstart something at the beginning, I think in Ethiopia's case, the state needs to do something because no one else is going to. In the case of, and it comes in Ethiopia's case, it's building in a capacity, an enabling capacity, be it power infrastructure, particularly amongst other things, that will start to result in light industrial base emerging. Start to build nascent consumer class and sort of hopefully it starts to compound and you move from there upwards. That's sort of the Ethiopian approach. Ethiopia, what it has on its side, is a big population behind it. Unlike the vast majority of African states, 30 of which have populations under 10 million, I checked, which arguably are, they haven't been able to, unlike Asia style, is to create, have or create a comparative / competitive economic advantage. Arguably, the majority of African states are economically non-viable. Arguably. And this is why this integration discussion is absolutely imperative. Because if we haven't realized this after 50 years, then I'm afraid we never will. Simple. And many of these states still trying to, they want the trappings of sovereignty, but I'm afraid the states cannot bear that burden of cost. Simple. So, back to the point. Ethiopia's story is about a capable state, for me, and how we define it. It's not about a political model, if you will. Secondly is the issue of next wave of Chinese companies. Yeah, I'm seeing beyond sort of the state-owned boys who come across, the big SOEs who come in, and are very distorted. I mean, how does a small African economy, with a very, very small private sector, with hardly any companies to mention, sizable companies, compete with state capitalism, which has such deep pockets? It's unprecedented. You simply cannot. So the playing field is totally, totally skewed. And I would say, again, state capitalism is the last decade or so from the Chinese perspective, amongst others to an extent, has really distorted the marketplace in many ways, a negative way. It crowds out private competition. Why have South African construction companies, big listed firms in this country, of which there are 5, 6, or 7, these companies have been decimated in Africa in terms of market share. But they're African companies. Why? State capitalism, as you allude to, Luciano. So, for me, the sort of last point, sorry, is this notion of the Chinese company, who's coming next. I'm seeing a lot of Chinese firms, big, truly private companies, nothing to do with the state. It's kind of a hybrid approach. They will use state money, of course, but the equity is entirely private, and the profit motive is totally delinked from national interest, from Beijing. These are companies out of sort of South China, out of Shanghai, who would never go to Beijing. And I've seen a lot of these guys coming through to the continent looking for real, real delinked commercial opportunity. That's a good thing, but it's very, very early days. I'm not sure how this is going to play out. But I think this state capitalism thing is, and again, making it relevant. Last week, our deputy president was in Beijing, South African deputy president, and I'm shocked to hear that delegation in tow is South African state-owned enterprises. So you've got the ESCOM guys there, you've got the post office guys, you've got, whoever else, Prasa, different crisis, different week crowd. And the discussions are, well, how do we learn from the state-owned enterprise model to drive growth in a developing society? Guys, we have Santon. This country has the most robust private sector, corporate-driven economy on the continent. And yet our politicians behave like they're from Ethiopia or living in China in 1978, before August story began. We need to lose the ideological sort of frame when engaging the Chinese and understand that this is, from a demand perspective, is incredibly enabling. From a supply side, again, from a capital deployment, incredibly competitive. And the word was used, mercantilist, earlier. Very mercantilist. It's not about models or ideologies. That's so 19th century.
Thank you. Memory, 2 minutes.
Thank you.
The question that you asked about countries being at different levels of development and thereby making it difficult for them to actually come up with joint strategies, it's a question that is often asked, and it's a source of puzzlement for me, because despite that, we still have a lot of plans that are already out there that are actually in motion. SADC, for instance, has a draft industrial policy plan, I think. At a continental level, we do have a strategy or framework for industrialization, for regional integration. So countries actually have been negotiating this, despite them being at different levels of development. So your question actually raises questions in my mind, like how many countries do we actually have that have domestic economic development plans? And how many of those countries actually go to the negotiation table with that plan in mind? Because if a country goes to negotiate something without actually having analyzed the domestic impact or what it means for it in the long run, then that country actually has no business being at the negotiating table. So maybe we need to, maybe toss away all the plans that we have and start from scratch, a bottom-up approach. Actually demand that every country sit down and think through those issues before they actually, we've been doing it anyway. We negotiate something, come up with a plan, and we revise it after 3 years, after 5 years, so, and then what's one more time going to it? I missed the second part of your question, actually, because I was busy thinking through the first part. And with regards to emerging economies coordinating their engagement on the continent, what I meant was actually in reference to the bigger projects, using infrastructure as an example, for instance. It would be good for the emerging economies to know which country is doing what in which country, particularly for projects that have got regional spillovers. I could be wrong, but I think the EU actually has, my memory could be a bit fuzzy on this, but I think the EU actually has a platform whereby different donor agencies from the member countries actually sit together and coordinate their activities, get to know who's doing what way to prevent overlap and to prevent duplication of projects. I think that would be very handy for Africa, and it would be good for emerging economies to have that platform. If they're not willing to have that platform, then African countries could actually create a platform for them, invite them to the table and discuss it. Thanks.
Thank you, Memory. That brings us to the end of this day's sessions. I note from our discussions that the issue of value chains has come up prominently. The issue of competitiveness and the accountability of our governments on how we engage our emerging partners is one agreed thread in all our discussions. At this stage, I'll invite Deborah to just wrap up the day and also to make certain announcements for the evening. Deborah.
Thank you, Dr. Tanasi. I have 3 minutes precisely, so it's clearly not really possible anyway, given the scope and breadth of the discussions today, to have any kind of effective summing up. So I think really I can just recall us to why we're here. We're talking about regional choices and global opportunities. It's so the question is begged, and this sort of came up again and again, as to why are we pursuing regional integration? Why is it necessary? And Martin provides the most compelling argument for that, actually, because many of our continental friends are just too small to do it alone. So we have to go together. There is also sufficient evidence to show that regional integration and regional market approaches has a very high correlation to economic growth, and I would argue sustainable and inclusive economic growth too. So this is a priority for us. The question is, what is holding us back? And Mark and Vina again explained it was this pursuit of the nation state and the strength of the nation state and the sort of political imperative rather than the economic imperative. Memory makes a compelling argument though for the need for coordinated activity. She argues we need to go far enough to cede sovereignty in some levels. Do we need to do that, or can we find more effective ways to collaborate, to pursue, to overcome some of the
the challenges and some of the things that Rachel said as well, about moving towards getting better regional level implementation of trade facilitation, for example. Some of the challenges we face that clearly need to be addressed are around trade facilitation. The issues of building competitiveness. Again, we'll come back to a lot of this tomorrow in discussions around value chains, and also we saw the start of a discussion around investment, because clearly that's something we're going to pick up tomorrow as well. And as we then take this forward, I can't really say more than this. It was just too rich a discussion. I hope, however, that everybody feels inspired to think about these things further